Gentlemen, it's playoff time, and our boys at DraftKings have a special announcement. With big stakes, bigger promotions, every day of basketball playoffs, DraftKings will have $20,000 in total prizes up for grabs. The best part, boys, it's free to get your shot at these daily cash prizes. Our boys at DraftKings will be offering two free-to-play pools every day of the NBA playoffs, offering us players. Ooh. A free shot at $20,000 in total prizes, Obes.
I'll take $20,000 up, dog. DraftKings free-to-play pools are easy to enter. Just download the DraftKings app, go to pools, and choose from a wide variety of free contests for an opportunity to win cash prizes. All you have to do is answer a handful of questions around what you think is going to happen during that day's basketball games and track your results throughout the evenings. Questions will range from which team will hit the most threes to which team will score first. DraftKings is safe, secure, reliable, so you can deposit and withdraw your money at your convenience, Broadway.
Download the top-rated DraftKings app now and use promo code CURFEWKINGS when you sign up to get your free shot at $20,000 in total prizes every day of the basketball playoffs. Head to DraftKings pools page to get your shot at huge cash prizes. That's promo code CURFEWKINGS for a limited time only at DraftKings.
Eligibility restrictions apply. See DraftKings for full details.
Curfew Kings.
Come on, baby.
Welcome back to a fresh episode of Missin Curfew. I'm Shane O'Brien, coming to you from Hall Pass Media in beautiful Newport Beach.
Newport Beach.
We got another great show for you. We're talking a little, we're still not done with the Derby. We got to finish up on the Derby now because there's some controversy. Me and Updog are going to wrap up the Rangers Caps brawl. Tons of coaches fired in the NHL. Trotsky healthy scratch in Barzell last week. McJesus, Updog's boy, gets 100 points. Sam Bennett doing some fucking in Florida. Jack Eichel's comments. And one of Updog's best teammates or favorite teammates finally gets 1,000 points. So we have an unbelievable show for you. First and foremost, my boy, William Scotty Upshaw.
Oops, thanks for having me. Beautiful day in Newport. You're right. We're getting ready for a big weekend here, fella.
Fucking Spring Classic, bud.
We got the Spring Classic at Big Canyon. We got the NHL playoffs. We got, I'm sure, a night of just some good old beer drinking, wine drinking, tequila drinking. So big weekend.
Speaking of drinking, you're doing a little mini kind of oil change, cleanse the body.
Damn juice. Press Juicery. How are you? That's a free ad read for you. I am doing their 3-day little tune-up. Just to clean out the system.
You know? Not a fucking oil change. It was like taking a Z-Pack back in the day, right?
It's been a day now. And I feel your goddamn pain, Oz, when you were going through those couple, 10 days. I don't know how you went 10 days. At least you can mix in a salad there. But I'm not just straight juice.
You sound like the guys that used to play against me. Mix in a salad, O'Brien.
Hey, O'Brien! Mix in a fucking salad!
Hey, O'Brien, you're going to eat yourself right out of the fucking league. No, but I could have a meal. I could have a shake. Two shakes at any time during the day, and then a meal, no more than 700 calories. I don't know if I could have just done the straight juices like you're doing, but you're going to be fucking down to about 120 pounds after this.
I don't think this isn't a weight thing. This is just this good old-fashioned cleanser, eh?
Oh, it's good for you too, right?
Mentally it's good.
Just be careful because every time I come off these things, the first time I drink, I get like high school girl drunk.
I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah. Well, I'll be your partner. Spring Classic for our listeners. It's our member guest, 5 9-hole match play matches. And our boy, William Scotty Upshaw, my boy, he likes to look at his phone a lot out there because he's doing deals for fucking Missin Curfew and Discovery and God knows what else. But
he's going to hide it on me, folks.
I'm going to stuff it in the golf bag on you.
Unless there's a nice deal, we have one of these sponsors listen to us on the pod right now and they're hitting us up because they want action here in the playoffs. You know, we're building this thing, Obes, and part of building it is winning this goddamn Spring Classic. I know that. So we have a big weekend ahead.
Hey, that'd be my luck. I'd make you put your golf bag or put your phone in your golf bag. It's a big sponsor. Oh, but we missed a sponsor, you fucking dummy. So
Pornhub, all of a sudden Pornhub comes and they're like, we need you guys here right now. We're filling up the room and you guys are a big part of it. Let's go.
Updog, we thought we put a bow on our, Missin Curfew Derby party. And then Medina Spirit, the horse, gets pinched for juicing. So Flowers, first of all, Give your money
give
back
us your
to whoever.
Goddamn money back.
And our boy Loophole hits us up yesterday in a group text to me and you and says, all bets are off. So I text the guy that I do my stuff with, and I'm like, hey, dude, I need my money back. And I haven't heard anything yet, but I think, you should get your cash back, shouldn't you?
I think that just throws a whole fuckery now into that whole thing, right? Yeah. A horse race is not just the winner and the second place and the third place. It's like, it's the combo packs, it's the trifectas, it's the box bets, it's everything. Mm-hmm. I don't know why they just don't test the guys and get the rapid piss test. I mean, they're doing rapid tests for everyone for COVID. How come they just can't rapid, get that horse to just piss in a cup right before he goes out there? Now,
you think they would?
I find it interesting that, he's still the favorite to win this week's Preakness. That's pretty special. The guy gets a full-on steroid positive test, and then he goes in and he's still the favorite. That's great.
Another great point by you.
You don't even get to sit on the bench.
So the owner's suspended. Whatever the owner's
he's
name.
He's done. That guy with the white hair?
Yeah, who always wins the fucking derby.
All his horses are just juiced up every year.
Yeah, so the horse can still run, but he's suspended. So anyways.
Now we can dive into that a little bit more. I think it's...
Dive into her.
That you're allowed to have that steroid in your system, but it has to be like a few days or I don't know. Maybe Max knows. It's like Max don't know. I think it's like... days before you can have that in your system, but it just has to be gone by the time the race is. At least that's what I heard yesterday from a guy. But fuck, I mean, figure it out. That's the Kentucky Derby. You can't like all of a sudden change everyone's bets. What if some guy won like fucking $5 million and got paid out?
Wow.
And then all like, good for him. What if a guy lost $5 million?
And then they're like, hey, we need that money back. You're like, ah, fuck, I already spent $2 million on a shaker, but I was out on a yacht in the fucking. So, Eddie O, don't feel bad. The horse you didn't pick, and it doesn't matter. It was fucking juiced up anyway. So, Up Dog, we got to put a little final statement on the Rangers Caps brawl. Obviously, a lot of guys come out of the woodworks talking about it. And, Kevin BX has said what he said on Hockey Night in Canada about. He's been in bigger pillow fights, and if you're going to jump on a guy's back, be prepared to. So not even about the scrub, but let's talk about what the Rangers did the next night. Granted, they weren't, it wasn't Probert versus Cox back at fucking Joe Louis Arena in the Rock'em Sock'em days, but three guys came out, dropped their gloves, and I thought it was a pretty good statement for the Rangers.
Yeah, you're right. It wasn't Bugard or Colton Orr going toe-to-toe, center ice, everyone in the barn and in the country with their jaw dropped to the ground. No, this was... What this was, Obi, was a gut check. It was a bunch of guys sitting in a room going, fuck, this is on us. This is New York Ranger hockey. This is bigger than us. This is about the game itself, and this is about our jersey. We don't have tough guys, no. But let's go out there and protect yourself. Don't go out and do something you're going to get hurt. No, fighting now, and I think our guest that's coming on today we'll be able to explain it further. Really hard to get really hurt in a fight right now, I think. Yeah, there's not many guys out there who have fought their whole lives exactly. And who can really, really hurt you with a punch. Now, there's going to be the time where you get cold clocked and you might, take one in the bean. We've seen that Kujar in Edmonton took one this year pretty big by, was it Stone? Or no, it was a kid from Calgary. He clocked him.
No, wasn't it Cabranson? Cabranson dropped some.
Goody.
Who
did
he drop? Oh, he dropped Cassie.
Cass.
I know who you're talking about. Oh, fucking Richie. Richie from Calgary. That kid's tough. He's like 6'4".
So those are the guys you worry about. Those guys know how to hit to hurt. I just loved it, Obes. And I want you to dive into this of what it did for American hockey at a time when ESPN and Turner steps up. But it just was a good chance for these guys to stick up for their teammate, Panarin is a guy, he's a fiery guy. I fought him. He's tough. He's, he jumps on Wilson's back. Something's going to happen. Wilson's a fucking, he's a man. He's a freak. He's tough and, test him at MSG. See what he does. You poke the bear, fucking bear's going to go buck diddy. And then, but touch on what it did down here. Cause we woke up the next morning. What'd you see?
Exactly. So it's obviously down here in the States, it's been Aaron Rodgers, everything first about the Green Bay Packers, which I think the Green Bay Packers are in one when it comes to that. Anyways, I don't think he wants to play there anymore, but I wake up in the morning, open my blinds, brush my teeth, fire on ESPN. First thing, Washington, New York Rangers, number one on ESPN. And now I did some radio shows in Canada throughout the last week, and they're like, is this really the impression we want to make in the United States? Yeah.
Shut up.
It is. Like, I'm not saying we need fucking line brawls every single night, because we don't, Uppy. And you know what? It's not even about fighting. Like, those three fights, listen, I'm not saying I was the toughest guy in the world, but those three fights, come on.
Yep.
The only thing is, the scariest thing about fighting is if you fall and hit your head on the ice. That's the most dangerous thing. Remember Georgie Parros back in the day?
I sure do. Yeah.
That's
really
scary.
I was there, actually. Yeah, with Florida.
That's really scary, yeah. Man. But nonetheless, these kids went out and dropped their gloves. It was on ESPN. And I said this to a lot of people, Uppy. You know, back in the day when I was playing, or if you go to a hockey game, when a fight breaks out, nobody's going to go grab a beer or take a piss. They're going to wait till the fight's over, right? It's part of our game. And I'm also saying this, Ups, is we just need good physical hockey, which build rivalries, which in the end, then there will be the odd fight, okay? But next year, I'm going to watch the Rangers Caps. I'll tune in the first time they play. I know you will too. Had that not happened, unless I was betting on it, I probably wouldn't watch it. So it's good for hockey. And I wanted to ask you this about this young Rangers team. They just let their coach go, which we're going to get into. But when you're in stuff like that, Uppy, when you're in a line brawl or you know, physical game, you know, you get back on the plane that night, like it builds character for your squad, right? You feel like you're a closer-knit group, and this Rangers team is on the way up. Like, how important do you think that is for these guys heading into the summer and into next year, being like, yeah, all right, Tom Wilson did his fucking thing, but we stood up as a group of three, fought these guys, and then kudos to Smith for fighting above his weight class, which is one of the hardest things to do in the NHL. It's going to make these guys a better team, obviously.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. And the guy that we have on later is a guy that always fought up, because you know why? His mentality was, if I get beat up, who cares? I stepped up to the challenge. What I saw in the New York Rangers was something that they can own that for the summer. They get to go home to their buddies and be like, yeah, we stepped up. We you know what? We got exposed, and we had a good second half. I mean, shit, when they got Panarin back, bro, it was like they were playing with a vengeance. All of a sudden, you're like, man, we counted the New York Rangers out all year, and now they're pumping Philadelphia Flyers every night they play. Mm-hmm. They're getting great goaltending. Their young players are stepping up. Finally, you know, Lafreniere starts playing well. Zibanejad, maybe an off year, but he keeps, like, all of a sudden he has these spurts of 4 or 5 points a night where you're like, all right, he's still an elite player. You can run with that guy. Adam Fox. I mean, what a year. So there's some upside to these guys. They're going into the summer at least saying, okay, now we address the toughness. We get a new coach. I mean, you know, that needed to be addressed. I think the front office, Chris Drury, what he's doing right now, addressing issues from a personnel standpoint in their coaching staff, GM job, you know, what they had as ownership, what James Dolan addressed. They're going to put pieces together. They're the New York Rangers. They have an unlimited budget. They have a chance to, you know, play next year in front of fans again, fill up MSG. You know, so I would expect all these guys to go into this summer with their heads held high. They stepped up, and they had a good finish to their year. And next year is a new slate. They'll have some toughness in their lineup. You can guarantee that.
You can guarantee that. And you bring up James Dolan. You know, I was on the golf course with you when the comments came out about an act of violence, right? A heavy act of violence or something like that, where we were both just kind of like, you're like, oh, let's read this. And 2 days later, president's fired, GM's fired. What were your thoughts on it? I mean, you know, Georgie Parros has a hard enough job to do. But I mean, it was a scrum with your gloves on that happens throughout hockey all the time. So I don't think you put it on Georgie. Were you shocked when Dolan came out and fired these guys? And from what we've heard is that Dolan wrote the letter, and then Davidson and Gorton went up and said, hey, you can't fucking say this. And he piped him.
Yeah, I heard that on your guys' Power Play show. What really went on, who the fuck knows? But the one thing is that obviously James Dolan was not happy with how his team was built. Whoever wrote the letter, I think they wrote it with the wrong intention and maybe the wrong language. It was a cry for, you know, for we got embarrassed. Well, you got embarrassed because you didn't have toughness in your lineup.
Exactly.
B, you can't single out George Parros. He is doing his job. It's not, if you want to call out the Department of Player Safety and the NHL, okay. When you say George Parros is not fit for his job, someone better have played in the game in the NHL and played like George Parros. If you're going to come out and say George Parros and is doing what he's, you know, doing now and doing a terrible job of it. George Parros is a great person, was an incredible teammate, is tough as nails, and he's probably smarter than most guys. So yeah. You know,
he went to Princeton.
He went to Princeton. Yes, he fucking got hit in the head a bunch of times.
You remember those crosswords that some guys would do in the morning at the rink?
Right? Mike Knuble would do them all the time.
Fucking Georgie Parros would do that thing, and I'm not lying, 15 minutes flat.
On the Friday New York Times, probably the hardest one.
The hardest one, just like big, 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 and then I'd be like, maybe I'll try that one time. I'm like, five across.
It's like, where can I put the X and the O in this?
But yeah, he's a genius. He's a very intelligent person, is what you're saying.
Yeah, exactly. That part... I think that just, once reading through the first paragraph, getting to the second and starting to be like, okay, enough is enough. I feel like I'm reading the fucking news lately.
Yeah.
Like everyone's just fucking crying and complaining about everything. It's like, fuck off.
Yeah.
So, you know, whatever. New York Rangers, get tougher.
Toughen up. Get some fucking guys in there with some balls. And if you're a young guy out there that listening to this and you're down in the jungle and you're 6'3" with fucking, and you can skate, work on your goddamn skill this summer, and you will. I'm telling you, they're making jobs for guys like this. Like they want guys to come in,
and then you better fucking learn how to chase some hot ass, because there are some hot ass.
Which we'll talk to our guest about when we get him on later in the show. So the Rangers, Caps, great job for the Rangers to step up there. Tom Wilson, listen, buddy, I like your game.
Be a beast, Tommy.
These guys are fucking out to get you. Do it cleanly with your shoulders down, but play hard, man. You're good for the game, and you're a playoff guy. So a segment brought to you by Goodlife here. In football, they call it Black Monday when all the coaches get fucking piped. So I guess we could call it Black Monday presented by Goodlife Clothing here.
I like that.
Because we've had some coaches can't, right? It happened Sunday, Monday,
It's the time of year. Pack your shit, coaches.
So we'll start with David Quinn, who, you know, listen, I had Quinner.
Where'd you have Quinner?
I had Quinner in Colorado the lockout year. He was our D coach.
Before he went to BU.
He's such a just, I don't mind Quinner, but he's just fucking
arrogant. Does he look at more chicks in the stands than you or me?
Well, he looks at himself in the glass more than, he looks at himself in the glass more than P.A. Pronto did. And P.A. Pronto looked at himself through the glass the whole fucking game. So to Quinner, like, listen, I just think, I don't think he's a bad, bad guy. I think, you know, like, fuck, he's a good looking guy, good hair. You know, I remember we had this one party, whatever it was, it wasn't a Christmas party, but you know how you get together with the other sporting teams in your city. I think it was for charity. And he comes in with this like 6-foot blonde rocket Quinner. I'm like, fuck.
That's respect.
I'm like, I guess I can't really.
Was she from Denver?
I don't know. I'm like, I just went up to him like, no, I think she was from like the East Coast Russia. Area.
He brought a Russian in.
I'm like, hey, Quinner, how much you pay for this one? Can I have her after you? I'll take her next one. Just he was his arrogance, right? Like, you know how much I hate. Bob Hartley's the only coach I actually truly hate, and you know that. But with Quinner, it was just arrogant. Like, we had a horrendous year, and I remember it comes in one day, and we're grabbing a coffee, you know, in the back change room, grabbing a coffee. And I'm like, all right, I'll say morning to Quinner. At this point, I haven't played in fucking a week and a half. We got like 3 games left. I'm like, morning, Quinner. He's like, morning, Obs. I'm like, how you doing? And this is like, he already signed with BU. He's like, oh, it's a great morning. Anytime you're getting paid by two teams and double dipping, it's a fucking good morning. And I was just like, it's true, but like, fuck you. We're in last place. You know, you haven't played me in 2 weeks. You want to tell me that you're getting paid by BU and fucking the Colorado Avalanche?
Tell him to fuck off after that.
I just fucking grabbed my bagel and went in and probably talked to PA or Factor. I was like, listen to what Quinner just said, this fucking clown. But for me, when it comes to, well, I watch the Rangers a lot, Uppy.
Yeah.
What you said about their offense is through the roof, but their defensive game, it was sloppy. Their D zone was loose. Their gap control was awful. And I just think if you're a GM, you look at this and, you know, David Quinn left the team for a bit I don't know if it was for COVID reasons, but they went on a run without him. So I just think his arrogance, I think he's better made for you know, BU or BC, wherever he wants to go back to. So Torts also canned in Columbus. Do you think, I text Torts yesterday and I just said, hey, congratulations on your 6, you know, years in Columbus and getting that team, you know, from not a very good team in the playoffs. Like, you changed the culture. I said, I had Foligno on the power play and he told me you came in and changed the culture of that organization and he had nothing but great things to respect about you. And he said, thanks, Olms. And then I said, are you going fishing? He said, you're fucking right, I am, Olms. He's a big fisherman. But could you see him going back to New York with all that, skill up front? If you bring in Torts and his little, well, chucking pens, you know, could that help them maybe, Ups?
Yeah, Torts' name, and this is the first year I've really dove into the media thing here, Robes, with you. Yeah. And you've been great, like leading the charge here. And Torts' name, man, he is fucking in this. He is in the news every day.
Yeah.
Do I think that's good for a team like New York in New York? Yeah, I think I do, actually. You know, they need to address toughness. Torts wants his players to play tough. Yeah. So he will see, you know, is he a good war room guy to sit around during personnel time before the draft, before free agency? Yeah, I think he's fucking probably perfect. Do I want the New York Rangers to be about John Tortorella again? I don't know. Do I think that... Is David Quinn a player's coach? I wouldn't say so, because Kevin Shattenkirk, one of my good buddies and one of my favorite teammates, had him. And yeah, although Shatty probably wasn't his best in New York, a lot of pressure on him, tough injury on his knee. You know, I felt like he didn't get treated with respect. So there was no respect factor to like an older guy.
He's arrogant. He's
fucking arrogant, right?
He's arrogant.
So Tortorella, can you come in back into New York? You know, when you got there the first year, your first tenure there, you had Richie, you had Marty St. Louis, you had a good crop of guys.
Yeah, like McDonough on the back end, you had Daniel Girardi.
You don't
Stahl.
You don't have Seth Jones.
Yeah.
Although that's a great place for Seth Jones to go.
Well, that's a great point by you, because Seth Jones, they got to sign, right? I think he's RFA though. I don't know if he's. I'm pretty sure he's RFA. You know, maybe he says, I love Torts, goes to, you know, signs in New York somehow, but their back end does need some help for sure. Yeah. Besides Fox, it's thin. But Torts, one thing about him, he teaches guys either you play the right way away from the puck or you don't play.
Yeah.
And when I watched New York down the stretch, I was like, fuck, these guys need to learn how to play the right way, Uppy. And there's only one way to play defense. You know that. You got to just dig in and pay attention to details.
Yeah. And do I think a kid like Lafreniere could learn from Torts? I do, but you know, it's tough. Like it's a different game. Like Max Domi couldn't handle it this year. We obviously see Laine. I don't know where he can handle it. He's
going back to Finland.
He's a year or two away from just head her back home. But there's a lot of coaching jobs up for grabs right now. Rip through another couple of guys.
I'm going to say one last thing on Torts. I'll tell you who doesn't want Torts back in New York is Larry Brooks, the writer for the fucking New York.
Oh, yeah, yeah, great.
He'd be like, oh, hey, Brooksy, oh, yeah? Yeah, you're probably the guy that got beat up at the bus station, weren't you?
At the bus stop, fucking right.
To Torts, good luck, buddy. We're pulling for you here. I'm going to ask him to come on. I'm just going to give him a couple weeks to do some fishing and stuff, but we'll get him going. We'll stay with Columbus and a guy we just had on last week, a great pull by you, and a guy I know you love to play for, Gerard Gallant. I think Columbus could be a good fit for him just because he's so much different than Torts. Now, like you said before we got on air here, you're like, fuck, you know, they don't have a very good team. Their GM needs to have a good offseason. But do you think Gerard could be a good fit there just because these guys have been dealing with Torts for 6 years and Turk will come in? It'll be a little more chill, a little more laid back, and maybe that's what some of these guys need.
I do because Gerard Gallant is a veteran team. He's a guy that kind of leads you into the promised land. You know, you have the confidence, you've had like the success a little bit. You kind of need just like a guy to come in that has, you know, good presence, but ultimately isn't like this crazy X's and O's guy. Like if you're used to that, it's a breath of fresh air when Gerard Gallant comes in. Now, we touched on it. They have some cap room. They need fucking help. Gerard Gallant isn't going to come in and help rebuild a team. I don't think that's the right fit for him. I think what he was able to do in Vegas in 2 years, in Florida in a couple years, with some younger guys in Florida that already had some mojo and some presence, you know, and they had Luongo and they had Yager, so that was like there was already some leadership to take on, you know. I always go back to Ken Hitchcock. The way Hitch would describe like a team and how a team needs to evolve was, I can only do so much. And then the guys in the room need to take over the team and they need to lead them where they need to go. I can only do so much. I don't want to be game 70 fucking. Yes, he would still yell.
But saying the same thing I said at game 20.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. I need you to come in and I need you to I need the guys to start steering this fucking ship and leading it. And that's why I thought guys like Steiner really knew that that was kind of how it needed to go. Petro would follow after, but it like that whole mentality of, you know, that coaching style, I think is what like Gerard Gallant can bring is like, guys, I'm going to give you like this game plan. I'm not a hard ass. I expect everyone to play. I'm honest. Like Gerard said, yeah. One thing Uppy that I am. And I told him is like, you'd straight up with me. He's like, I was a player. So that's how I wanted it to be too. And mm-hmm. that message resonates with younger guys, older guys, honesty. So yes, I think Columbus would be a good fit for Gerard. I would like to see him go somewhere where I think he's going to have success. I'd love to see Gerard Gallant win a Stanley Cup. Do I think Columbus is that team? I don't. So we'll see.
So there's also some rumors about him, and we were going to bring it up to him, but we didn't want to. Detroit, right? You talked about Stevie Y making him go get a bucket of fried chicken for him, which fuck, I still think is hilarious.
He was the captain of Detroit before Stevie Y.
Can Turk go in with a, let's be honest, well, I guess Columbus and Detroit are kind of the same boat, but can he go in there with a young group, you think, and help them rebuild in that way? Because I think with young guys, I think he could be patient. I think if you gave Turk coaches get either 3 to 5 year deal, if you give him like a 4 or 5 year deal and say, hey, come in here, change the culture, help these, do you think he can develop young players, Uppy?
I
think he can too.
I love playing for him. You get in a meeting, he's fucking around in his pocket. He's got all his coins. He's hilarious. But he's like hilarious. We'll be in a meeting and you'll hear just like ding 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 ding, and you look and he's hands in his pockets. It must be an East Coast thing. I swear my fucking family does it too. And he's just like playing with his keys and shit. And you're like, hey Turk, we can hear you. Like fucking. Anyway, it's like he's got a good just mojo.
Yeah.
And guys want to play for him. You know, there was probably and Revo talked about it too when we had him on, was like, that was hard, man. It was hard to watch, you know, a guy go in the middle of the season. But when a guy like that leaves a team, man, there's an opportunity for him to go in and you know, be that guy on another team eventually. And I think Gerard Gallant is a guy that's going to be picked up. Do I think Detroit Red Wings in a rebuild stage that they're in with Stevie Y? I think the chemistry there is probably great, right? Like, you know what it's like when you have a GM and a coach that actually sync.
Yeah.
And you come on the bus after a game, whether it's a win or a loss, and there, you know, there's not this like fucking, you know,
tension.
Yeah, tension between the GM and the coach. That's tough.
And players, you can tell
for right? sure.
You can 100% tell if the GM and coach aren't getting along. Like. In Calgary, Jay Feaster, who I love, I wish maybe he didn't love me as much. He traded for me twice, and one cost me the cup, the other one got me out of the league. But you could tell him and Bob knew that Berkey was coming in and Jay was done, and you could just you could feel the tension, and that's not good for anyone, Uppy.
No. And I understand the pyramid of leadership and how that needs to go from the owner to the president to the GM to the coaches and so on. Now, that disconnect within GM and coach can affect everything. It can affect when you go on a 2-game skid and all of a sudden there's blame getting pointed everywhere. Fuck off. We're going to lose 2 games. Like, just let us play. Let us just get out of this ourselves. Like, you know, we were talking about before. Detroit, Jeff Blaschel,
and their assistant coach there is Disco Dan Bylsma, who was the Stanley Cup champion in Pitt, but...
So we'll see. We'll see if these guys get piped or if they're still in the mix.
That Blaschel's been there forever. He's been there for a while now. And I'm not saying it's his fault. Listen, like, their team last year were fucking like
the stench from Buffalo's coming over the lake and just hitting them right in the face.
And we're gonna get into the stank in Buffalo. Another coaching. We had Gerard on last week and he was like, I just want another NHL opportunity. And then he wakes up this week and there's fucking 4 or 5 jobs. So I'm sure Turk's fired up. Seattle. Rick Tocchet, who, first of all, listen, I had talk a little bit in Tampa. I mean, he's a beauty. He's an unbelievable guy. The way he played the game, we all know he's an absolute killer. He's a beauty. I thought he did a good job in Phoenix. You know, the situation there is tough, right? You played there. It's not easy. There's the ownership. You can only spend so much money. He's out of there.
Fuck, they spent their money this year. Did they? They were right up there.
Were they right up
there? Let's actually look here. I want to say... Because that's a good point, Obes. But they This year, the fucking, what do you call them? Well, Arizona Coyotes.
Because they brought Phil the Thrill in.
and they just were paying, they're paying cap.
Caps. Well, they're still paying Bowley. Are they still playing Bowley?
Bowley, fucking Nathan Horton. I don't fucking know. Who knows?
But anyways, look it up. But then talks, they're saying, you know, obviously with his play with Ron Francis and Pitt, you know, that he's the front runner for Seattle. I think Gerard Gallant's in the mix in Seattle too. But I mean, I just think talks would be a great fit for an expansion team. I thought what he did in Phoenix, listen, they played great this year. There was a stretch where they were like 4 points ahead of the Blues, and then because of COVID and the schedule, they went on a 9-game road
trip.
They
had the fucking easy schedule. They really did.
But they had that long road swing, and they went like 1-8, and they were done. So
final cap hit for them this year, $80,575,000. They only have $900,000 in cap space left. So that I actually thought the same thing. But when you sit down and talk about it, you're like, you know, shit, these guys are, they should be better. They should be better.
Yeah, I guess they should be. But they got a good coach in Dallas Eakins. I think Talk's a good head coach.
Yep.
I think Seattle's a good spot for him. I've also heard that if it's not Seattle, he may go. I heard Philly's going to pipe all their assistant coaches. Terrien and your boy is your
Yosi.
Boy.
Yosi's
Mike, there. Yo. So we'll see what happens.
That's the rumor?
That's what I heard the other day.
Poor Philly, man. They're just fucked.
I know.
Like, I mean, poor Ed Snyder.
Well, Carter Hart forgot to play hockey. Forgot how to. Yeah. Like, if he can come back and be the Carter of Hart that they think he's going to be.
I know. I just, you know, Philly, like, there's teams out there that really pour, you know, blood, sweat, and tears into, like, their team and, you know, fan base. And Philly was always like that. And I just don't know if that's. Yes, I would love to just walk down Market Street or cruise around Rittenhouse Square and just ask people, you know, that were diehard Philly fans if they still, like, love the way the team's being run. And, you know, I just don't know what I know what the answer is. It's fucking no. We hate it. It's so
anyway. It's a big offseason for Chuck Fletcher in Philly.
Yeah.
He's got Voracek still under contract, Giroux, JVR, who came off to had a great start to the season and then faded off. Their biggest concern is their back end. They need to tighten it up, and they need to tighten it up big time. So one last thing on coaches real quick. Our boy Trotsky, last week or maybe a week and a half ago, healthy scratch Matt Barzal for his play away from the puck. Do you think this is a smart decision, trying to just a wake-up call? I mean, it takes a lot of balls to scratch your best player when, and I love Trotsky, when they were having such a hard time scoring goals.
Yeah, I think this is a prime opportunity for us to do another segment sponsored by Oura Ring, our sleep tech ring monitoring all our sleep, because the New York Islanders had been sleeping. They had been sleeping for a while. I think this is a wake-up call. This was a chance to get a good night's rest, Barzal, and the rest of your team, because come playoff time, if we don't score goals, we lose. We are not going to compete against Pittsburgh at all. We'll get swept if we play like this. And I think Trotsky, being the coach he is a guy that, we had Bird Dog. We had Hartnell on. He scratched Hartnell in the last game of the year. He played 80 fucking games in a row, and all of a sudden him just to wake him up, because, hey, you can't do this in play. I need you to watch the game in order to be better in the game.
Yeah.
And sometimes that's just at the end of the day, you hate the guy. You know, I hated Trotsky when I played when I was young. I didn't know, and he was hard on me, and by rights he should have, because I was a young kid. I was chasing it at the tin roof. I was having fun.
It was chasing you at the tin roof. It was chasing you at the tin roof.
So, you know what? Barzal comes out and plays better, and he scored a couple goals, right? He came out of that.
They finally played better. They beat the Rangers twice. He got a couple goals. It was ballsy by Trotsky to do it. It kind of flew under the radar with all the Rangers brawl and stuff. I didn't even really hear about it until my boy Steve Cooley's told me, Cools. And I was like, holy fuck.
That's where I heard you guys talking about it.
I'm like, holy fuck, he scratched Barzal. Listen, I thought after the Islanders picked up Palmieri and the Zajac was a throw-in, Zajac's been horrendous. He's been awful.
He's old. I'm actually still shocked he's in the league.
I know. I thought it was like a good throw-in, but he's been horrendous. Palmieri hasn't found his way. I'm concerned about the Islanders, man.
They done.
Yeah, they can't score. I thought the way they were playing it heading into the deadline, I'm like, fuck, this could be the best team in the East, but if you can't score, you know, you can't fuck.
Right? There ain't no fucking on that Long Island. Until the Hamptons opens up here this summer, then there'll be a lot of that.
Yeah, hey, you're going to poke your head in the old Hamptons?
I might have to. Yeah. So. I like Montauk. How are you?
It's a time. So the coaches out there, Gerard Gallant, there's lots of spots open for you too. Up leads us into another segment presented by our boys at Cannadips. I got a lip tumor in right now, American Spice. You like the American Spice?
I'll have one right now.
It's good. It's kind of like...
Fuck it. It's the one that
wakes
actually,
you up with your morning coffee, which I'm having right here too.
Yeah, it's the one that actually zings in there. Like if you got a little a cut zinger. On the inside of your lip.
Yeah, if you got a canker sore in there or something.
Yeah, if you're eating too much box, you're fucking in one.
Up dog, these guys fuck presented by Cannadips. And the guy that's been doing more fucking than anybody maybe in the history of the NHL on the ice. We're off the ice, you could throw your hat in the ring for that one, obviously. But your boy, who you've been just talking about all year.
Zinging, McDavid.
McJesus, McDavid, he did it. And you could see when he made the backdoor fucking pass to Drysdale, and Drysdale ripped it home.
Drysdale's like a horse.
Oh, yeah, Drysdale, sorry.
He is a horse, though.
Did I say Drysdale?
Drysdale.
That's the fucking guy that plays defense for the Ducks, the young kid, that's why. Drysdale.
And what's the horse? What's the horse called? Clydesdale.
That's what I am. I'm a fucking, Clydesdale.
Oh, yeah. Moving
Drysdale. You could see he makes a typical Connor McDavid. How are you? Backdoor. Drysdale rips it home. That guy has Datsuk one-timer style. You could see McDavid's reaction. You know, you don't see it much. He was kind of relieved, like, fuck, I did it. I think even for him, he's like, wow, I got 100 points in 53 games.
Fuck.
They have more points combined, Draisaitl and McJesus, than the rest of the forwards on the Edmonton Oilers. Now, that's reason for concern.
I think they have more points together than the Ducks' whole team. Let's look that up.
They might. So
what do they got? 100? They got 180 fucking
188
points.
I bet
you they got more fucking points than the Ducks have goals.
Them together, Draisaitl has 88 points. They got 189 points or something now because McDavid has 100. No, they got more than that, 190-something because McDavid's got 103 now, doesn't he? Look it up.
Oh, my God. Buddy, they have more. They have more points than almost every team has goals.
Drysdale's got 81. McDavid's got 102. So they got 100. Wow, that's crazy. 183 points together.
So they have just in. I don't even know if this could be a legit stat, but there's only five fucking teams that have more goals combined than they have points. Now, that's like McDavid and Draisaitl are in on almost every point. They have 178 goals this year. And how many points together?
Together? I'm not sure. To combine, they have 183 points together.
Yeah, so they've only scored 178 fucking goals. That's great.
I mean... Think about that. Great. That's fucking insane. I mean, and then our boy Tyson Barry, shout out to Bears, 46 points.
Yeah.
He may end up leading the league in D scoring. So for Bears, when he signed that 1-year deal for four bananas.
What a pickup. Smart. Kenny Holland, great pickup.
Smart.
You know what? I'll give you even credit because you needed to find someone to put with McDavid. And it looks like.
You could put me and you with McDavid.
Yeah, I know. But has it worked in the past?
Well, their power play is number one in the league, too. So Bears has come in and done.
Puljujarvi stands in front. He's a terrible style, but he's actually doing his job.
He's got 25 points. He's got 15 tucks, Puljujarvi. Do you think you could get 15 tucks playing with McDavid if your body held up?
How many games has he played?
53.
Fuck. I had 18 the 1 year before I got hurt in 46.
I know. So I'm saying if you could.
All those fucking Finnish fans out there, you fucking chirp me.
If your body could have held up, I think you could have got 15 playing. I'm talking this year. If you would have stayed healthy this year, you could have got 15.
I'm waiting for the call to go to the World Championships. No one's fucking going over there. Hey. But anyway, let's talk about the pace. Lemieux, 100 points, 38 games. Gretzky, 100 points in 50 games. Jágr in 52 games. McDavid, fourth all-time for quickest to 100 points. That's just special. He was doing it at such an epic pace down the stretch. I think he had 36 points in the last like 13 games.
15 games or something, wasn't it?
36 and 13. Fucking nuts.
He had 28. He had 28 points in 10 games. That stretch there alone, when I saw that stat, I was like, Jesus.
So you know what? Connor McDavid right now is doing everything in his power to make sure that his team is dialed in and ready to go for the playoffs. Edmonton fans, my Northern Alberta crew up there, shout out to everyone in Fort Mac. Let's get these fucking Oilers fucking buzzing.
All right, listen.
Let's get them through Winnipeg and let's get them on into the fucking quarters.
I'll tell you another thing about the fucking Edmonton Oilers. Shout out to my boy, Mike Smith.
Mike Smith.
He should be a Vezina finalist. He's got, what has he got, 20 wins, save percentage of .924, goals against of .228. The guy's 39 years old. I mean, listen, there was a lot of concern about the Oilers going in about goaltending. People said they should have improved it. Smitty was kicking. McDavid, Uppy, I got another question for you. First of all, the Mario, the 100 points in 38 games, Mario, wow. I mean, that is fucking...
How much French tickler was he doing that year?
Oh, man. There was a movie I used to watch as a kid called Mario the Magnificent.
Yes.
Fuck, was it good. It like started off with him jumping in his like Ferrari or white Ferrari, right Lamborghini, and driving the rink and here the goals he would score. Up. Yeah. The Hart Trophy. If Connor McDavid is not the unanimous... If some fucking pigeon writer out there doesn't vote for Connor McDavid, he should lose his vote.
Yeah, right? Totally.
Like, I don't care. Crosby had a good year. Come on. It's Connor McDavid. Everyone vote him. Let's get him a unanimous MVP. I don't care if it's the North Division, Uppy. This is insane.
Now, he's got two hearts now, I think. This is his third. Yeah, you know what? Give the kid, I should probably double check that. I'm not the statistician guy that I used to be.
It's early here. We're early in the studio this morning. But
Connor McDavid,
I got the coffee going.
Congrats on the Hart Trophy. You heard it here first.
Unanimous. Everyone out there with a vote. I don't can't believe we still get a vote, Uppy. I mean, we're media guys now. Give us a vote. Vote for this fucking guy. 100 points with no fans in Edmonton, freezing his balls off.
This doesn't matter to him right now. He knows legacies are only built on winning and on Stanley Cup, on being a Stanley Cup contender, a winner. And he's going to be a fucking man on a mission. If he already wasn't this fucking regular season, boys.
I can't wait.
I'm really excited for him, for the squad there. Dave Tippett, man. Keep her going. Get the fucking boys.
Hey, Dave Tippett, grow the mustache back for playoffs too. Hey, grow it back.
It's a six stash.
Grow it back. I want to see it for the fucking playoffs.
Does he not have it right now?
No, man. Remember when he shaved it? He's like his lip.
Oh, yeah. Right? He's got it. Yeah. His lip don't move too much. It's because he's had that duster on there forever. It's always weighed it down.
You're going to have to reach out to McJesus and get him on the pod. Don't make us get flowers to text him, all right?
I got him.
Hopefully they win the mug. Second guy brought to you by Cannadips that's doing some serious fucking is a guy that you said at the deadline. I was pumping Montour's tires to Florida and you were pumping Sam Bennett and you love the pickup. He did something that not even you did in a Florida Panthers uniform up, dog.
How many threesomes has he had?
I think you beat him in that category. Not even the Russian Rocket did this. He's got 15 points in 10 games. That's the first in Florida Panthers history. I think Coach Q should win the Jack Adams. A lot of people are saying Rod the Bod. Their GM, what's his name? Bill Zito?
Zizi.
Started off the year saying he was going to scratch Yandel, which was a fucking rookie move. But his deadline pickup, Sam Bennett, it's been out of this world.
Yeah, it's just why I love that move so much, Ovi, because it reminded me a little of my experience in the league with watching guys just get new opportunities and what that breath of fresh air is like for a guy, a young kid who's getting stuck in the depths of Calgary winters and, showing up to the Saddle Dome every fucking day and
rink sucks.
Dealing with that bullshit, just like you know. But Sam Bennett, good on you. What you're doing, you're not playing outside perimeter hockey. You're fucking going to the hard areas. You're playing strong. You're playing tough. You're on a good fucking team. Let's talk about the fucking scraps they had the other night, too.
It was unbelievable.
Tampa Bay, fucking Florida Panthers. We got a nice playoff match here.
We got the sunshine fucking
tilts.
Sunshine showdown.
The sunshine fuck fest.
It's going to be a great series. I just think the way he's gone in there, and listen, when he was in Calgary and he wanted out, I was like, oh, fuck this poor guy. He was drafted fourth overall or third overall. You know, well, listen, that's just a prime example of a guy that said, give me an opportunity to go somewhere else. You went through it as a sixth overall pick, and he's gone in there. And like you said about the salad on Uppy, I played in Calgary, and no disrespect to Cowtown. It's a great city with great people, and I love the
Stampede.
I love the province of Alberta. Fucking Prince here, our boys up there. But it's a tough place to play, especially if things aren't going well, right? Like, I went through it. I lived it. It's hard. And he was going through it. That pickup's unbelievable. I just can't wait to see that playoff series. And to him, congratulations, Sam. That number there, that stat, that's doing some fucking up, dog.
Yeah. Anytime you're fucking chasing the Russian rocket, whether you're chasing him down to Miami for a night out, man, or what, that guy used to live in South Beach.
I guess
and play
he
for the Panthers.
Did.
It was like, just because I've done the drive a few times, obviously.
Stick handle.
It's like an hour and 20 minutes to practice. I don't know what fucking Ferraris he was driving to the game or whatnot, but I'm sure he had car service. But that is like legendary. I remember being there and some of the guys being like, up dog, you wouldn't live in South Beach. The only guy ever to do that was the Russian rocket. I'm like, fuck you. You tempt me. I just might.
And it was like Aves. I think Aves was the last LA King to live in Hollywood and play for the Kings.
Yeah, he was. Yeah.
Because their practice rinks out in fucking El Segundo. I don't know. If I always thought if I played for the Kings, I would have been. I would have been somewhere in Hollywood. But anyways, those guys, our segment, these guys, fuck, presented by Cannadips. Good on you both. McDavid, Jesus, man, I don't know. And the scary thing is he's going to get better. So to an organization that's not doing any fucking really, our boy Jack Eichel, who came on the pod, who I got to experience Coachella with as a young kid. Just his comments, Uppy, about, you know, since his injury, there's been distance in the organization. I mean, first and foremost, this guy's got to get healthy.
Yeah. Slide that right over to me. I know what it's like. I've been hurt. I don't know what it's like to be fucking Jack Eichel. Let's just clarify that. He's a beast. And he's got a lot of cash.
Yeah, he does.
He's got some funky hair. I'll take my hair do over Jack's any day.
Good playlist. You know,
he can do a playlist. He can set up, I'm sure, a nice little dinner night out with the boys. I'm sure he's that type of guy. But what I think is happening on in Buffalo, it's time. You fucking have traded away every good player that's ever been in that dressing room alongside him. And how do you do that? McDavid has Draisaitl. Who does Jack Eichel have? He's got fucking nobody.
I guess you could say Sam
Reinhardt.
Yeah, he had a good year. But he's not Draisaitl.
You got to give a guy like a little hope. You got to get him. You got to get him a goalie. Yes, they have, you know, some young D-men that haven't really panned out. Dahlin's one of them. He was really good when he was 18, and now he's fucking soft as...
He was supposed to be the next Hedman, right? But yeah.
But maybe he comes back.
Yeah, true. But he's still young.
But the injury thing. You deal with your best player getting injured. You need to know that he has his best interests in mind. You don't think he's going to fucking do anything that's going to affect like his body moving forward and put himself into a spot where he's never going to play the game again. And they sometimes these teams act like that. You listen to like a trainer, and yes, I'm going to say it. Trainers always don't have your best interest.
Oh, they work
have the fucking interest of putting you out, you know, on the ice, not missing man games. And quite frankly, Jack Eichel, he's going to have access to people to look at an injury that are better for that injury than someone sitting in Buffalo in the dressing room telling him like this and that. Now, can he use this as a reason to get out of Buffalo? I think he can, and I think he's exercising that. I think he's basically saying enough's enough. This was the tipping point. You guys have been, you know, you've been shit for getting me players and, you know, creating a good team and a good atmosphere here. I can only do so much. Now it's time for them to trade him, get four fucking first round picks and move on. Dude, seriously, trade him for, get the fucking wheelbarrow full of picks and move on. Let Jack Eichel go play somewhere where people will appreciate him, where he'll sell lots of jerseys, where he can score 50 goals, where he can play with great players and have a chance to win the Stanley Cup, because it's not happening in Buffalo.
Exactly. And first of all, when you talk about the trainers, listen, I've had some good trainers that are really great guys, and I had some trainers that are complete donkeys. And bottom line is they work for the team. Mm-hmm. That's their job, to keep the guys somewhat healthy and get them back on the ice. So Ike's, first of all, and even if you're the Buffalo Sabres, first and foremost, if you don't want to trade him, you got to get him healthy. So like, I don't know what the fucking disagreement is there. Like, if you kind of need surgery, get him surgery. Second of all, Uppy, like you said, listen, I feel sorry for Buffalo fans, man. I loved playing in that arena. I've partied in Chippewa Street in the offseason, man. It's a fun little city. They love their hockey. Thank God the Buffalo Bills are good. The Blue Jays are coming there to play for the summer, so at least you can go watch the fucking Vladdy Guerrero show. But it's time to trade him. He doesn't want to be there. Granted, listen, he's your second overall pick. I get it. It stings. But you want guys that want to be there. And Buffalo, you got to start all over again. And Kevin Adams, you got your hands full, but you better know what you're fucking doing, because, listen, it's ugly and it's only going to get ugly. If Jack Eichel's healthy next year and he comes back, they're still not a playoff team. They're not. I don't care. Unless Ike goes McJesus style, they're not a playoff team. So trade them, get the picks like you said, move on and start the rebuild again. So to the fans in Buffalo, go check out the Jays. Vladdy's having a year. Have some beers. Hopefully good things ahead.
Have a dog.
Uppy, one of your favorite teammates. I know you're a guy we both played for. You respect him a lot. Paulie Walnuts, we call him in Denver.
Oh, nuts.
Paulie Stastny, 1,000 matches. Touch on it real quick for the boys.
I saw it last night. I loved it. For me, a guy that has fucking played a lot of hockey, man. And he's been good. You had him early in Denver. He's produced points and face-off wins and winning battles and just making the right plays. And fuck, he's not the fastest guy out there. Fuck, he can hardly keep up.
Yeah, he's smart though.
But he is smart.
Yeah,
he and he's a great guy. And fuck, does he, smart guy, really smart guy. Loves to sit down, have a nice intellectual conversation. You know, talking about,
maybe that's why we didn't hang out too much.
Talking about the stock market and fucking, you know, his old man too, Peter Stastny.
His brother's a good guy, Jan Stastny. Jan Stastny, real quick.
He is a legend.
He was Black Ace in Vancouver, and the two years there, or whatever, they would not let these Black Aces come anywhere. But every time we only won the first round, but I would see him out after the first round. He'd be drunk at the fucking roller or down in Yaletown. I'm like, where have you been hiding, buddy? He's like, oh, they don't let me come around you. But I'm like, have you been enjoying the city? He's like, oh, yeah. So he seemed like a beauty, too.
Jan's a beauty, yeah. Jan's like the older, just more beauty brother.
Yeah, he seemed like a fucking beauty.
You know, he probably has a little bit bigger curve, probably a harder snapshot. But fuck, he's not.
But his bank account's not quite as big.
Yeah, his bank account's not big. But Paulie Walnuts, man, shout out all your teammates you play with. Respect you. You're a fucking good man. Those little mini sticks that your kids got are such a classy touch by the Winnipeg Jets. So good job up there. And then fuck, man, go win a cup. You've been close a few times, and you know, now's your time. You got a tough road ahead here, facing off against McJesus.
Yeah,
try to slow him down. Just get your stick on him on the draws, and then just don't let go. But shout out, man. 1,000 games, a big accomplishment.
Yeah, man, good for you, Stas. Fuck, it just seems like every other week this year we've been guys that we played
all
against.
Our buddies, yeah.
Still doing it, so.
Fucking rights.
We're worried about the Spring Classic. They're worried about winning the Stanley Cup. So times have changed. But real quick, Milan Lucic, Waves is no move in Calgary. I think this is a perfect fit for Seattle. I think he could go in there. I don't know if they want to name a captain right away, but why not? He's a British Columbia boy. He could go in there with his Stanley Cup pedigree. And you know what? Luch played well this year. You know, he's still skating. He played well. I think he wants to go there. I think his family would enjoy it. I think he'd be closer, obviously, to British Columbia. So to Luch, I hope that works out for you. And if I'm Ron Francis, I'm taking this fucking guy. No brainer.
I think so. And you know, the money will work itself out, right? The money will work out. Ron Francis, cap crunch those numbers and make that happen. But he's a guy that'll help your young guys out. He is a guy that if the New York Rangers had him, that wouldn't have fucking happened with Tom Wilson. So again, there's a lot of reasons to have Milan Lucic in your lineup. And one being that he's just a good West Coaster and he deserves a chance to play, under those umbrellas in Seattle.
And he's like a household name, right? Like he 100%. Would go in and he would sell jerseys for you guys and stuff like that. I think it's just a great, great fit.
How about, I'll bring this up, and I don't even know if it's on our checklist of things to talk about. Pekka Rinne. Pekka Rinne, 60th shutout in the NHL. Could be his last start, Obi, in Nashville. Got a standing O in front of 14,500 fans.
He deserves it. He is one of my favorite teammates. You know what I love about Pex?
He puts in a fucking big old dipper.
Yeah, and he just fucking, he would always catch the puck. No rebounds.
He would catch the puck
this way. Never a rebound. I'm like, that a boy, Pex. Keep catching that fucking thing so I don't have to clear the front of the net.
That's a Finnish thing. The Finnish guys catch a crossbody. And Mitch Korn always told that, our goalie coach.
Mitch Korn. I want Mitch Korn.
Fucking that little, he's a fucking little, I want to say troll, but he's a tiny little fucker.
He's a little guy. I like Mitch. He was
fun. I love Mitch.
Yeah.
Fuck, he helped. He won. Well, he helped build Thomas Vokoun, Chris Mason, and Pekka Rinne in Nashville.
Yeah.
And then he went to fucking Washington, and he had a couple guys in Washington. He just followed Trotsky around.
He loves Trotsky. He's in Long Island with him too.
Who
now.
Who was the goalie in? Oh, Holtby. So then he literally, I think, turned Holtby into the goalie he is too.
Did you ever have the shooting coaches like get you to do the shooting drills before practice? I was never like, they never really picked me to do it. I was like, which I didn't mind, you know, because I needed a few more minutes in the hot tub. And
I just couldn't hit
going.
My targets, so no, they
that's
didn't.
That's why I mean, the times I did do it, they're like, hit the fucking net, Obes. I'm like. Yeah. I got fucking one goal this year. Why you got me doing the shooting drills?
It was always the little fucking jock sniff. It was like the coach cock sniffers.
There was one guy, what was his name, in my rookie year in Anaheim. He was a French guy. Fuck. But he would come in the room.
Joel Perreault?
Pardon?
Joel Perreault?
No, he was a goalie coach for Jiggy. He would come in, he'd be like, I need two NHL shooters, not Georgie Perros, not Obi, not Sean Thornton. I need NHL shooters. Francois Allaire. I need, and then the odd time I'd have to do it, he said, Obi, I said NHL shot, NHL shot. I'm like, fuck, I leaned into that one.
Is that Jiggy's guy? Like, did Jiggy have
him
his
whole
career?
Yeah. He was Jiggy's guy.
I like when that again is something that, you know, that relationship. The coach, the goalie coach and the goalie need to have a good bond. Because that's who like sticks up for the goalie when the fucking coach is yelling at him, and like that, there can't be a disconnect there either. That needs to be like the goalie's buddy, because these goalies need to get fluffed up sometimes. You know,
you gotta fluff them. Up dog, we got our playoff matchups. We got them, except for possibly Vegas could still win the West. I don't think they're going. Colorado could still win the West. I don't think they're going to. But let's start in the north. I'm excited just to see Toronto, Montreal. The fact that there's no fans sucks, but I think Toronto gets that done. Edmonton, Winnipeg. I'm going to take Edmonton. Would you agree with those two scenarios in the north, or do you like an upset there?
I'm excited to see the red and blue fucking face off. I got to be honest.
I know, me too.
So is my old man. Big Scotty sitting in Newfoundland right now having a couple Coronas fucking working out on the lawn. He's a Toronto guy. Fuck, does he hate Montreal.
I didn't know that until you said that last week.
He fucking hates Montreal with a passion.
Fucking writes Big Scott. So do I.
Yeah. So the Toronto matchup, I got Toronto winning that in six.
There you go.
I got six games for Toronto. And I got the Oilers beating the Jets. I got them beating them in six as well.
Love it.
So I got fucking, we got a lot of hockey to watch, and that's exciting.
I can't wait.
Northerners, I know you've been waiting for the playoffs. You got four fucking teams in the playoffs. Let's get one of them to the Stanley Cup final.
You got four teams in the playoffs for the first time ever, maybe. Yeah. Has that ever happened before? I don't think it has. Uppy in the Mass Mutual East. We got Pitt, Long Island, Washington, Boston. I'm going to take Pitt. Fuck, this two out of three, this Washington, Boston, I'm not sure. God, it's going to go seven. This is the one we might be able to have a watch party for. Oh, do I have to pick today? It starts Saturday. I got to pick today.
Yeah, let's just fucking hammer it.
Who do you like? You let me think. Pick.
Boston Wash?
Or who do you like, Pitt and Long Island? You like Pitt?
I got Pitt in five.
Wow, a short little fucking how are you?
The Islanders are, but they can't score. But listen. Trotsky somehow gets these guys to fucking play the tightest. Their anus is so tight for the playoffs time. It's crazy. But they fucking, they play winning hockey somehow in the playoffs. But Berkey, fuck, he's got the boys fired up. Sidney Crosby, Jeff Carter, Malkin's back. Fucking, they are going to walk
these
guys.
They look good. They got Carter's playing like it's fucking 2010. I'm going to take Washington in seven against Boston just because I want to see Sid Novi play in the second round. But that,
I'm going to take Boston.
That's a fucking, that's going to be a battle. That's,
I'm
going
to take Boston in five games.
Wow. Holy fuck. Well, hey, in your defense, Washington's banged up. Their guys came back last night, but they're not 100% healthy. So the Discovery Central Division, Carolina, Nash, Florida, with home ice over Tampa, which if you would have told me at the start of the year, I would have bet my fucking pad and CDM that that wouldn't have happened, that Tampa would have A, not won the division, and B, not had home ice in the first round. Listen, I'll tell you what, Nashville, if that full building's rocking, you know, it's you played, it's hard to go in there and win games. But I'm going to say Carolina wins in probably six.
I'm going to take Nashville.
Wow, you are.
Come on.
Love it. Brad Richardson, another shout out to Richie. He's going to be a playoff guy. Stay healthy, Richardson, you old fuck. They need you in the faceoff circle and killing penalties.
What's the what's the song they play?
I like it. I love it. I want some more of it. I can't get enough of the Predators scoring. And then they do fan fingers on the power play. Fan fingers.
Don't they have the growl too?
Oh yeah. Yeah, we should maybe go there for a game.
I think we should.
Uppy's upsetting it. And then listen, I love what Florida's done. I love Coach Q. I love Monty. I love Weegsy. I just think if 86 and 91 come back healthy and Hedman can stay healthy, he's dinged up. I'm not betting against Tampa. Tampa in six.
I got the Panthers.
Fucking right up.
I got the Panthers in... Fuck. Is Valesky healthy?
Oh, yeah.
He's healthy.
Oh, yeah.
He saves him with his cock. I am going to bet right now that Florida beats Tampa Bay in seven games.
Wow.
And that's going to be on home ice in Sunrise, baby, California.
Hey, to the Florida Panther fans out there, get out and support this team. Get to that rink. Come on. They're in the playoffs again for the first time since Updog went full Updog on the bench against Jersey. So get there, support them. They've had a great year. To Coach Q, you fuck. Good job to get the boys going. And then the Honda West out here where we've been.
Our
Blues got in.
Hockey down here, boys.
Let's assume Vegas holds on to win the West because I think they will. They got to play San Jose Saturday. They're going to beat them, and that'll do it. The pesky Blues, Uppy. Can they do it? I know their captain, Ryan O'Reilly, thinks they can. He is so fired up to play some playoff hockey. It's unbelievable. He says Binnington's focused. Can they beat Vegas? It's a good matchup.
I don't think they can.
I don't think they can either. Fucking I'm sorry,
Vegas
Factor.
Is so good. Sorry, Bobo. Sorry, boys. Fucking A.
I bet the Blues the other night, though, they beat the Kings for 2-1. Thank fuck.
That was the craziest bet I've ever heard of. We don't need to disclose why.
I'm going to say Vegas is going to win, too. Sorry, boys. Fuck. And I know you talk about Army a lot, and listen, they have great pieces. I just think Army, in the bottom half of his lineup, needs to add some speed. You know, the only guy I really see buzz out there is that Cahoon. Even Thomas looks slow to me.
Oh, yeah. No, not that's the Edmonton guy.
Oh, not Cahoon.
You're talking about, it is Kyrou.
Kyrou. What did I say? Cahoon? Kyrou. He can Kyrou. Buzz. And when I mean buzz, like you see these NHLers now, the way they stop and start and fucking, you know, it's just like they need a little bit more of that, if you ask me.
Yeah, like he and Robert Thomas drafted the same year, both like World Junior Canadian kids. Kyrou was very highly touted, and it just took him a while to get going. Now, what he's done this year has been insane. I mean, I'm just going to look at his stats right now. He has 12 and 20, 32 points as a, you know, a first year full-time player. That's not bad.
No, he's good. And listen, I think Schwartzy, they're probably not going to resign Schwartzy, right? Although he's a guy that plays with speed and can forecheck. They should resign him, but
he wants to bring his talents to South Beach.
He does, eh?
Not to or South Beach,
to Cali, probably.
He wants to be paid. He should.
Yeah,
he's
I agree.
He's a great player.
So we're both taking Vegas?
Yeah.
All right. Sorry, Blues. We love you, but we're taking Vegas. And then Colorado Mini. This is going to be a tighter series than people think. If Colorado can stay healthy, which I hope to fuck they do this year, I'm taking Colorado in six. And it gives us a Vegas-Colorado showdown in Vegas, which we, the Missin Curfew crew, we'll be there.
You're damn right.
So that's our picks. You good with Colorado over Mini as well?
Colorado over Mini in five games.
Yeah. So Updog, it's been a great year here to the NHL and to the players. Congratulations for getting through a COVID season. It wasn't easy. it wasn't easy playing the same teams over and over again. In fact, watching it near the end of the season, I could hardly watch it because it's like, I've seen these guys play 8 fucking times. They're going to continue to play in the playoffs. But I would say, Uppy, it was good that we had hockey. It helped our podcast for sure. To the players, way to sacrifice. And it's time to watch some playoff hockey, and I can't wait.
It is time. Ba-dum-bum-bum.
And our next guest, who loved playoff hockey and chucking them and living in New York and Montreal and partying with you,
oof.
Brandon Prust, coming at you next on Missin Curfew.
Breaking news. This important PSA is brought to you by Manscaped.com. This is your pubic service announcement, just like Jay-Z, boys. And the news we've all been waiting for. Fellas, the Manscaped engineering team has confirmed that they have successfully created the Lawnmower 4.0 Trim Daddy, which is available for purchase in the U.S. of A and our boys up in Canada.
Up in Canada, these boys, they've been locked down. I know you boys up there need the Lawnmower 4.0.
Fucking bush
keys. I know you guys up there in Saskatchewan, Ontario, especially Ontario. Come on, let's get those balls looking good. Summer's around the corner. Uppy, I've already used the first lawnmower. I can't wait to use a Lawnmower 4.0. I cannot wait.
You got
to
lose the caveman mentality. You got to get out there and trim her up. Broadway in Boston, I mean, you got to be trimming the nose hairs and the goddamn chest. What do you got going on in Boston? Oh,
boys, I just got my Lawnmower 4.0 in the mail. And boys, I can't wait to take this to my chest flow right now. Tonight after this episode, I'll be taking that Manscaped Lawnmower 4.0 and being one of the first to use it.
Get the chest flow and trim up the balls. Maybe take the family to Fenway Park. Hey, Broadway, that sounds like a nice day after you got the lawnmower all trimmed up.
I'll be about 10 pounds lighter, Obes, I'll tell you that.
I know we've been talking about this guy a lot because he kind of reminds me of Connor McDavid. But, boys, I think Elon Musk's engineers have been doing just some crazy work on this for our testes, just to be full-on smoothie Douglas, soft as baby butter. You know, these girls, I mean, they're going to be just indulging
in some
freshly shaved banana hammocks.
And after you shave it up nice, I know I say it every week, but get the fucking ball deodorant, get the ball toner. And then if you got stinky feet after the golf course, they even got foot deodorant up, dog. They got it all at Manscaped, man. I'm telling you.
Optimized lawnmower, boys. Waterproof, so you can groom in the shower, not have to worry about messing up the bathroom floor. I know the old ladies, you know, they don't like when they see all the curly bajurlies on the floor.
Just be careful of the drain. Clean the drain out, right? The old lady might get mad if you leave the pubes in the fucking drain in the shower. But just clear that out. Get the lawnmower humming. You'll be good to go, ups.
And just a heads up for you sick fucks. If you're still trimming your face with your ball trimmer, now's time to make some changes. Get 20% off and free shipping with our code CURFEW at manscaped.com because no person wants to end up with pubes in their mouth and your balls will thank you.
Welcome back to Missin Curfew. Up Dog, another great guest, legend on and off the ice. A guy that I had some run-ins on and off the ice with. Who did you get for the boys this week?
I have a guy here coming at us from London, Ontario. The absolute beauty. I was part of a trade with the Phoenix Coyotes when we brought like a fucking, I think we brought 10 or maybe 10 or 11 guys. We'll ask Prusty. I can't remember. But trade deadline, Gretzky's our coach. We bring in like 10 guys at the deadline. It was like training camp. We all go in with different bags. We're trying to fight for who's going to wear what gloves and whatever. there was not enough gear in this dressing room when we all got there. But one of my favorite teammates for only a short period of time, but a buddy I always used to see when we go on the road and hang out, Mr. Brandon Prust himself. Welcome to Missin Curfew, Prusty. Thanks for coming.
Yeah, thanks for having me on, boys. Glad to be here. You guys are doing a great job. So I've been waiting for the call. I mean, I thought I'd be number one or two on your list, but I mean, I'm down there. That's fine.
No, hey, listen, we should have had you up the depth chart a little bit more. But after the shenanigans the last couple of weeks, I'm like, I text up you. I'm like, we got to get fucking Prusty. I'm like, text him. This guy is the exact guy we need right now. So we appreciate it.
Yeah, no problem, boys. Thanks for having me.
You're up in London, right? You can't golf. None of that nonsense. I feel sorry for you, fella.
Oh, yeah, you just said it. Nonsense. It's complete nonsense. Yeah, no golfing. Like, at least let us walk the course. Like, don't even put carts out. Say, just come, like, stick the thing out. People can pay with their debit card. Let them go golf.
Let us go just piss all over the trees or something. Come on.
Yeah.
Leave the beers out there for us.
they were shutting down ski hills, but then you could go, your kids could go toboggan on them. Like, it just doesn't make sense.
It's definitely messed up. But Prusty, obviously the first thing we wanted to ask you about, buddy, was you know, the Tom Wilson incident. I know it was last week, but it's still being talked about. And obviously the way you played the game and played for the Blue Shirts, it wouldn't have happened on your watch, but just your thoughts. And it wasn't as bad as everyone thought, in our opinion. What was your thoughts on it?
Yeah, when I first watched it, I saw everybody going nuts, you know, on social media. And I'm trying to watch, and I'm like, did they think like he cross-checked him when he fell down and he crossed? I'm like, he didn't cross-check him in the back of the head. And then he kind of gave him a punch to the face, which was kind of like just a, you know, a little like Marchand, like, you know, rat punch type thing. Right. And then I see that it's pretty much about the throwdown. Like, Panarin's on his back, jumps on him like kind of like a monkey on his back, and he's hanging on for dear life. And I know it looks worse, but Wilson's a big guy. Panarin's a strong, big guy too. Like, you know, he's one of the best players in the league, but Tom Wilson's got, you know, old man strength. And I think if it's anyone other than Tom Wilson, I don't even think it's a discussion, but because it's Tom Wilson, you know, people are getting tired of some of the stuff that he's done. And if I were Tom Wilson, like, I would just stop hitting. Like, you can't even hit anymore. Like, especially hitting somebody coming across the ice, like, don't even touch anybody. And it's his game, but I would just say, don't even hit anymore. Just, you know, if you can bang some guys against the boards, but he can't do anything anymore without people wanting him to get suspended. So I think if it's anybody else, we're not even talking about it, but because it's Tom Wilson, you know, people want his head.
Prusty, I agree. That's something we've been talking about here on our podcast lately, is just the view on him. Obviously, you're a social media guy. You know, there's people out there just trolling him, waiting for him to do something. What, like, this whole cancel culture thing on hitting and, you know, whatnot, the game still needs to be rough. A guy like Wilson, I love it. I you know, going to the box and going full Hulk Hogan style, I think that's just, I think that's on the New York Rangers not having anyone. He wouldn't do that if he knew there was a guy that was just going to stand and look at him from center ice and go, okay, you know, you do that to my guy, you're going to step up to me. But the whole, you know, your thoughts on this, like, social media, as so many people just come at him from all over. And it's, you know, towards the latter half of our career, we didn't really you know, it started, but
yeah,
it wasn't in full effect. What are your thoughts on that? Because I can't deal with it. It's like people
always ask me. So when I do stuff on like Twitter or something, and then you get like that mob that comes after you, I always get messages from people saying like, hey, we're on your side, but I don't want to deal with those psychos. Then you have people even asking like, are you doing okay? Like, they're really going after you. And I'm like, I don't give a fuck what those people say. Like, they don't know me. I'm just putting out my point of view. I don't care about these. Like, people don't know, even when they say fighting in hockey should be gone. People that say that, like, they obviously don't understand the game. If you ask any player in the NHL, especially Panarin, you know what Panarin wants after that Tom Wilson thing? He wants tough guys. Right. So that's why Dolan's getting rid. Like, they didn't build their team. Tom Wilson knows he has nobody to answer to. If I'm on that team, or, you know, we still have like, if they still have Brendan Lemieux, that might, you know, put something in his mind. Cause I know when I played, if I owned the ice, I did whatever the fuck I wanted. If there was somebody over there, like a Lucic or a Reeves, I was like, I might not fucking throw down their best player, slam his head. And like, I might not take a run at your best player, because I know I'm going to have to fucking fight someone that might kill me. So that's the point of having the tough guy, is to stop stuff like that happening. So there's people that are saying they just want to get rid of anything physical. Like, go watch basketball. Like, watch a different sport. They want them to stop hitting in football too. But then they'll watch UFC on Saturday nights. Right? Doesn't make sense.
That's a great point.
But Prusty, you gotta love the response from the Rangers the next night. And we got some clips of you on the Missin Curfew. You've been involved in some of the open and ice face-off tilts and lots of fights throughout your career. Can you tell us, like, how did that go down? Like, is that being discussed in the locker room, or is like that just, they know that scenario just going into that game?
Yeah, I think that for that scenario, I don't know what the coaching staff would have done. Like, oh, who do we put up beside Tom Wilson? You know, that's the same situation with, I mean, it's not the same situation, but, you know, good on those guys for doing it. Even now, you know, I know fighting's up and people are like, hey, the fighting's, you know, kind of back up, which I love to see, even though it's the equivalent of back when we played, like the second liners fighting, like they are messy fights. Like you're like, oh my God, that's painful. But at least, you know what? At least they're fighting.
Like my fights.
At least they're chucking them. Like I am good on them for doing that. Even though those three fights were, you know, pretty, a little like.
They were pillow fights, Prusty.
I don't want to chirp like they're all.
They were pillow fights.
Hey, but you know what? So it's like the saying, hey, it doesn't matter. I'd go after the biggest guy because it didn't matter if I lost. I would still go after him, right? Because at least you showed some balls. So, I appreciate what they did. I know with our fight with, it was me, Rupp, and Bickle against Jansen, Bolton, and Carter. And that was basically
Royal Rumble.
They threw that starting lineup in, and then Torts comes in, and Torts says, listen, they're starting their fucking meatheads. I'm not saying you guys have to go out there and fight, but we're not fucking backing down. Prusty, you're on the right. You're moving from the D to take the center. We're like, don't fight. But we're fucking just like, I'm like, okay. And Bickle comes up and Bickle's like, hey, how do I take the face off? And I'm like, it don't fucking matter, Bickle. Like,
oh, buddy. I played with Bix in San Diego. He's a fucking beauty. But I remember that. I remember that line brawl, and that was a fucking line brawl. But Prusty, my question to you is, and that's a great example. I talked about the Rangers guys stepping up. Granted, they weren't the best fights in the world, but the fights you've been in and the guys that you've gone to war for, building character in that dressing room, and this young Rangers team moving forward, this could have been the best thing for them moving forward as a group.
Yeah, for sure. Like, stuff like that can even change a season around, right? When you see some guys that shouldn't be fighting, I know it was always big when we played. If you saw like one of your, you know, it's like Anaheim when they see Getzlaff fight, or, you know, you see one of your top guys, you know, getting into it and backing up teammates and sticking up for teammates, that can really put you know, a charge into a team. So obviously you can't really tell this year because it was at the end, but it can definitely build character in the dressing room for sure.
And Prusty, you mentioned Dolan, and we, you know, when the statement came up, me and Uppy were golfing and you looked at it, and I think it was like they used the sentence of like a horrifying act of violence. I was like, wow, that seems a bit fucking out there. But like, just talk about Dolan as an owner. Do you think maybe he wrote the letter and that's why they piped the president GM, or what was it like to play under him as an owner?
I mean, Dolan was always, you know, you can't really say anything bad. He's different. He's a different guy for sure. But man, do the New York Rangers treat their players like top quality, and they'll defend their players. And I mean, that is a grade A class organization. They're top notch. So, and that's a lot with Dolan. He'll spend the money and he doesn't care about the $250,000 fine either. I remember Dolan's just like, I remember one time we're sitting, he would invite us to sit beside him at the Rangers games. The Knicks game. So he sits right beside their bench. So I was there with my uncle up in like the green room, and the waitress comes and she says, can I have your tickets? And I'm like, okay. And I give her my tickets. She's like, Mr. Dolan has requested that you and your uncle sit beside him tonight. I'm like, all right, Kev, we're sitting right beside Dolan front row. So I remember during the game, though, we're watching the Knicks game. And, you know, I know all the guys because we share the same practice facility, and I'm watching him all the time. But I see him on his Wikipedia Googling one of his players. I text the boys. I'm like, Dolan is Googling one of his players. And it's not like a bench player. It was like someone like, you know, pretty.
That's why they're so shitty all the time, except this year.
This year they're finally good. I just remember Dolan Prusty putting Charles Oakley out of the fucking guard. Remember that a couple years ago?
They
gave him the rough ride out of there.
Like he doesn't care, that guy Dolan. He doesn't care. Like he just does whatever he wants, really. Like, and you know, I can't say anything bad because he was always good to me. And you know, He treats his players and he spends the money on his team. So what are you going
to
do?
Yeah, he always took care of, he always used to take care of Harv too when Harv played in New York. So yeah, there was time I sat front row there a couple times with
I remember going when I was trying out for the Leafs and I asked him, I was like, hey, Golden State's in town. Let's go watch the Raptors game. Me, Matthews, Marner, and Anderson. It was their first year and they get us four tickets. And then I get the bill for like $1,600. And I'm like, well, we're 28 rows up. I'm like, I got Matthews and Marner here. We're sitting 20 rows up. I'm like, I played in New York. If I said I wanted to go to the Knicks game, it was like, here you go. You're in the front three rows sitting beside Spike Lee and freaking whoever else. Like, it was just the way they treat their players is like far beyond any other NHL team.
Speaking about a guy who wouldn't be sitting in the 28th row, he would have been sitting on the floor, was Henrik Lundqvist. And I got to know Hank a little bit. I partied with him in Vegas when he won the Vezina, and just an unbelievable guy. But what are your thoughts on him and obviously what happened to him this year? Not the way he would have wanted to go out, but he'll be the king of New York forever, yeah, right?
Oh, for sure. Yeah, that guy's a legend. And he was one of my good buddies. I still talk to him lots and you know, see how he's doing. And he's just a competitor. You know, he didn't want to, he wanted that cup, you know, he was hungry for it, and sucks what happened to him, but he is definitely the king of New York and always will be. Like, I'm surprised they didn't just make him head coach. He might be head coach next year. Seriously, like, that guy can say whatever job he wants and he will be given it. So he doesn't have too much to worry about, that guy.
Was it just his consistency, Prusty? Like, I played in front of some good goalies, Luongo, Pekka Rinne. But for Hank, like, to be under the bright lights and deal with all the stuff off the ice, like, fuck, his hair was never out of place. He was doing modeling. Was it just how he handled everything that was the most impressive thing?
Yeah. He was pretty calm. Cool and calm, and he didn't really know what he was doing. But I know when it came game day or when it came to practice, I mean, that guy was a competitor, man. Like, I would try and squeeze pucks by him, like, even when he wasn't looking, just to get some by him. And he would be the corner of his eye, like, he would stop the puck, stare me down. Like, he did not want a puck to cross that goal line ever in practice. Like, even if he wasn't in net and he tried to shoot one in, he would like go and stop. And so that guy was just a major competitor. When it came game days, I especially the nighttime, I didn't talk to him, didn't even look at him. I didn't want to get in his way. I was just like, Hank's in his zone there, leave him alone. And he was a competitor, that guy.
I just don't know how he gets his hair to look the same. Like, it's just a never hair at a place. Oh, it's really impressive. Oh,
God just did something to him that just makes everybody else pissed off. Right?
I remember playing against him, Prusty, in the national anthem. I'm like, all right, he takes his helmet off. This will be the time you can see if his hair, and his hair is just perfect. You're like, fuck, he just took warm up with a goalie mask on. So he's an absolute beauty. Prusty, a guy who I love to play for, I know you did, John Tortorella, was just let go by the Columbus Blue Jackets. A lot of players from Columbus say they got nothing but respect for him. Just touch on Torts and what he was like to play for. And do you think he'll get another job in the NHL?
I think so, for sure. I know the league's getting pretty soft, and his coaching style is pretty hard. Like, you don't have the player. Like, we liked it. I like when a coach, like, if your team sucks, like, come in and kick a garbage can and fucking yell at people and tell somebody they're a fucking bitch or a pussy. Like, you know, that's what you wanted. And he also treats player, whether you're making 10 million or a million, like, he's going to treat you the same. He just wants the, you know, the most out of his players, and doesn't want, he wants everybody kind of on the same program. Like, he needs a team of foot soldiers, right? Like, that's what he needs, because he's just so passionate. I don't know how anybody can, I can see how people don't like him, players, because he will get on guys, and you can see him if guys don't, some guys go the other way, right? So I know guys like us, if you kind of get yelled at, it will make you better, right? Like, you're like, all right, he's right. But you get the top guys and they're like, never been yelled at like that. And they'll be like, what the fuck is this guy doing? Shut up. Like, I know what I'm doing. I'm the best player, you know, and you can see them kind of dwindling. I watched players kind of get worse the more he rode them. So I think he has to learn. And I don't know if he has, but it looks like he hasn't, because of the way what he did with my name as soon as he got there. So he's still riding those guys. But for guys like us, I know that we appreciated it and we loved it. I, you know, this guy was X's and O's, amazing coach, the game plan, this guy just lived and breathed hockey and was just so passionate. So I look at Torts as like the Trump of hockey. People don't like him. People don't like him because he's mean and he's super, you know, says what he wants. That's Torts. He's the Trump of hockey. And but in the background, like fucking the guy's just passionate and a fucking great dude. I love Torts. He's just a passionate guy. Yeah, he was mean to me. I didn't go fucking sulk. Like that's people can't take that nowadays. So but he'll get another job for sure. He's a great coach.
What about a guy like Brad Richards? What was so like, you know, important about him that Torts loved? Because he had him in Tampa. They won New York. Yeah. It seemed like it was a so much respect. But you look at the way Richie would have played. Like, if you're that skilled guy, you better do things every night that like Torts loves, right? Because you do hear guys like Obi and yourself, guys that Torts just knows what he's going to get. And like he expects it out of you, and you love like the fact that okay, Torts is going to be hard on the good players. There's a respect factor within your room.
I think Richie just, you know, he played the game the right way, right? He didn't cheat, right? Offensively, Torts hated when guys cheated offensively, right? So Richie was never that type of guy. He took care of his own end, and you know, maybe if he's not like, you know, even near the end of his career, like diving in front of shots or penalty killing and stuff, he still played the game the way that Torts wanted to do and would still win the battles. That was it for Torts, right? Like, you know, don't be cheating. Make sure you're winning your battles. You know, you're still playing, you know, the physical game. Obviously he's not out there crushing guys, but Richie just played that brand of hockey that Torts loved, right? Play it this way. And Richie did that. I remember when Richie first got to New York, it was like, you know, the first year, and I got Richie and I became good buddies. And Richie started off a little slow, and we started off a little slow, and Torts just, you know, being Torts, just, you know, this guy probably didn't sleep right if we were losing. So we're out after the game one night, and Torts must call Richie on the way home, and Richie comes in, we're going for dinner. He goes, Torts just called me. He told me to like do drugs and stuff. Like he's Torts is like, Richie, I don't know what's wrong with you, but like go out, like get fucked up, do drugs or something, man. I was like, oh, this is going to be a good night.
He never said that to me, Prusty. He never said that to me.
I think because he knew Richie wouldn't actually do it.
Just lighten up a bit. A little false hope.
That's here. Fucking hilarious.
Prusty, what was it like playing with guys like Sean Avery's and Alex Burrows and Derek Dorsett, guys that just love to wreak havoc in games? Like, were you guys just kind of in the locker room looking at each other each night before games? Like, how the fuck are we going to disturb this game tonight?
Which guys did you say?
Sean Avery, Burrows, and Dorsett.
Oh, yeah. Well, I never played with Dorsett. Well, I played with Dorsett in Vancouver.
Yeah.
So, yeah, playing with Dorsett, Avery. Yeah, we would always – yeah, that's a funny thing, right? But I always found it more with, like, when I – because I'd always play with, like, the heavyweight. So I know sometimes there was, like, a competition in that way of – I would want to give him a break, and I'll be like, yo, I'll take their heavy tonight just to give you a break because you've been fighting their heavies. But Avery, like Dorsett and stuff, like, yeah, those guys I would, you're always like, hey, we got to spark the team, right? Let's just fuck. Playoffs, I know a couple times if you kind of lose that first game or you're down, it's like, hey, these first couple shifts, there's not a puck. Like we're just fucking hitting everything. We're changing momentum. We're, you know, so yeah, there's always fun stuff like that. I enjoyed playing with Aves. Aves and I, you know, played good together, and you know, we fed off each other pretty good, but it was always interesting to see what Aves was going to do next and what kind of brawl we were going to get into. Like the one against Edmonton when he fucking dropped Ladislav Smead. Oh, man, that was a good one. I didn't know. We didn't talk about that. That one just happened.
Hey, Prusty, the last thing on the Rangers before we move on to some stuff up in the North Division, your old Montreal Canadiens. I always used to say, especially this beauty, I'm like, fuck, I would love to play in New York. And now looking back, I'm like, what if I really loved it, though? Like, how hard, not the fans, I'm talking about away from the rink, the distractions and everything's going on and the fucking hottest girls in the world. Like, do you just have to get there and be like, okay, I'm a National Leaguer, pick your spots? Because I got to be honest, I don't know how well I would have picked my spots in New York City.
Like, I can see Uppy's really interested in this conversation.
Well, I've been out with you in New York before and after games, so I know exactly what –
You know what I mean?
But I know exactly how to do it. I didn't play there, but I know how to do it.
No, I know how to do it too. When I come in and play the Rangers and we both play the Islanders for 2 days, I could go buck Diddy with Mac L. But if I'm Prusty and I'm playing there, like, was it hard or you're just, how did you embrace it?
Yeah. It was hard. I think it can be, we had a pretty good group of guys too, where we'd get after, but we also didn't always, you know, push it crazy. But we had a good group of guys that liked to, you know, we were going out for sure. And definitely the women in that city is incredible. You got every hot model in the world, an actress, like, and if you play for the Rangers, if you play for a professional sports team in New York City, like, you can have your pick. So, yeah, it's definitely a distraction, but you got to keep your, you know, you got to keep your head on. You got to be, we're pretty good that way. I think we also had a good team. We knew we had chances to win and stuff, but we definitely, New York can be a tough place, but man, did I love that city. Like just walking around at night and just going to cool little bars and restaurants and some of the best food, and you meet the most interesting people. Like, you can wear whatever you want, and it's like, you can literally wear whatever you want and nobody, it's like, oh, that's the fashion. Sorry. Like, it's crazy. Yeah. It's a good town.
I used to love just peeking over my left shoulder on that bench at MSG and checking out who's behind Prusty. Yeah. Who's behind Prusty on that bench over there?
Yeah.
Those are Dolan's boxes. He'd just fill it with like world-class models from all over the world.
Oh yeah.
Uppy, who's the hottest girl you've seen behind that bench there?
I ended up taking one out on a date one time. She's a Canadian chick. I'm not going to mention her name. Prusty might have, you know, he might.
I think I might know who it is.
Yeah, because I ended up meeting her down in Florida. But no, in fact, another story in warmups, I was skating on on the other side of the benches next to the penalty boxes. There was this smoking hot babe working like with a little clipboard in her hand, and I couldn't stop like smashing my stick against the glass to get her attention. And then finally, like, she starts laughing at me, right? So I'm like, okay, I got her. I go over to Frosty on the bench and I'm like, Frosty, you know the drill. And then when I'd say that to him, he'd write my number on a puck or like at least my name with like an @SUpshall9 or whatever on my Instagram.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I go over and, you know, catch her eye again and then just fucking toss the puck over to her. And then shortly thereafter the game, get a little text or a DM and that's all she wrote. But she worked for MSG. So Dolan, good job on hiring and packing the girls.
Oh yeah. And we used to always jump. I used to TV timeouts. You're always jumping over the boards, doing the little lap there and stretching on just to look behind the bench.
Prusty, there was something about those lights at MSG though. Cause I remember sometimes I wake up with my pregame nap at whatever hotel in Manhattan, be on the bus going through traffic in the city and being like, this could get ugly out here tonight. Like, fuck, the Rangers are good. But then you come out there, they fucking put that bright lights on you, the energy. And I was like, all of a sudden, I wasn't fucking hungover anymore. Like, just the excitement there every night's got to get you just juiced, right?
Yeah, it was better the old gardens. Now that they've renovated it, I remember playing there, and it wasn't the same because it wasn't like they were on top of you anymore. The old-fashioned way was they were really right on top of you. And the fans are just awesome. They're, you know, some of the best fans in the NHL easily. And they were right on top of you. And it's like they light up that ice. It's the stands are a little darker, but the ice is just lit up like a Christmas tree. And you come out. That place, and you're just the middle of, you're at MSG. You're at the most famous arena in the world. So that building puts some, gets your blood pumping.
They actually put a clip up on our social media, Missin Curfew, when Marty St. Louis. You never played with Marty, though, did you? Or did you play with Marty?
Oh, never played with Marty.
The Mother's Day one.
When he scored the Mother's Day goal, it was in the playoffs, and that fucking MSG Prusty was rocking to that goal.
That was against us, right? That was the overtime winner. Was it the OT? Was it the OT winner against the
Montreal?
It might have been. Yeah, it might have been. Yeah.
I was watching from up top. I got suspended for hitting Derek Stepan, breaking his
ball. Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's right.
Your buddy.
I'm pretty sure. Yeah, my buddy. hey, it's for love of the game, boys. It's for the sport. There's no friends out there. Oh,
I've taken a few two hands from you in my day. Damn sure.
Oh, yeah. Prusty, let's talk. You've been up in London, obviously, and the North Division. We know what Connor McDavid's been doing, but there's also been some people hating on it about it's the weakest division. Just your thoughts on what's going on up there. Touch on Connor. I mean, it's unbelievable what he's doing, and just the whole North Division.
Yeah, Connor's, that guy's in a league of his own. I don't think anybody touches him. Every point, every goal is a highlight reel, I think. Yeah, he's fun to watch, and I don't think there's anybody better than him. In that division, I mean, it's going to be interesting to see what happens kind of in the playoffs and then when they cross over. I know the Leafs are looking awesome. You know, Edmonton and Winnipeg, everyone's looking pretty good. I think Toronto comes out of that division for sure. That's what I'm thinking. And who knows what's going to happen when they cross over. That's the thing, right? They've only been playing these teams, so nobody really knows what they're compared to. You know, I don't know. Who do you guys think is coming out of the other divisions there?
I think Tampa, Carolina. I think if Tampa stays healthy.
Carolina's, yeah. So it'll be interesting to see. But I think Toronto's got a great chance. I think they got the team to, you know, make that run. And I think this is the year they got to try and do it.
Goaltending worries me up north. Mike Smith, his heart's there, his competitive's there. Like, can he save pucks for Edmonton? Because if they can, then who knows with them? Campbell or Freddie, like, it's still just kind of a question mark to me. You know, the best goalie's probably Carey Price.
I saw a stat about Edmonton Oilers that Draisaitl and McDavid have more points than all of the other whatever 12 forwards combined on the whole team. Draisaitl and McDavid have more points.
I mean, you can't count out Pricer. Pricer just stands on his head, right? Whenever the team wins a Stanley Cup, who's their best player, right? So it's always the goalie. So, you know, Pricer just gets into this magical zone that he can get into sometimes, and he just becomes a brick wall. Who knows?
I agree. And you bring up Pricer, and we'll turn over to Broadway next, but you bring up Pricer and he's battled some injuries. And obviously, you know, firsthand more than anyone about the Montreal media. And there was a stupid cartoon earlier in the year that had him with overpriced on it. There's some rumors to him going to Seattle. Do you think maybe his time could be done there? Cause from what he's dealt with, just being the number one goalie in Montreal, he's got to be kind of over it.
He's still one of the best goalies around. You can only be as good as the defense are in front of you and clearing pucks and taking away second and third chances, turnovers. You see this guy just getting buried, 2-on-0s and shit like that. People are like, yeah, Pricer's done, but look at the goals that they're scoring, right? So if you called me tomorrow, I'd say, get the fuck out of there. Go somewhere else. Like, you're done with that place. They don't appreciate you. I'd book it. See you later.
Yeah, Prusty, I was actually going to ask you about that because you played in New York. You've obviously loved that experience. And I wanted to ask you about your experience of playing in Montreal, like being underneath that microscope. Does that become a pain in the ass? Did you think guys kind of don't want to play there, or did you enjoy playing for a big time Canadian city?
I do. I like that atmosphere. I feel it makes me better. I like that adrenaline rush. I always like playing for hockey market teams, and Montreal is that's an adrenaline rush right there, right? Going out in front in the Bell Center, especially during playoffs, and but in Montreal, the media can be, you know, it can be a lot. Some guys, that's why a lot of guys are just happy playing in Dallas and Florida and Anaheim and LA. Like they just play the game and they don't have to worry about all the bullshit away from the rink. Right. So Pricer's, those guys don't even want to go to the grocery store anymore. You know, like they can't live a life. So, you don't feel sorry for him cause he's had a great career, but I would love to see him, you know, kind of be himself again. Right. And just live as a human being because he's literally kind of not a robot there, but, yeah, just those guys, you can't do anything anymore. You can't go out to eat with somebody, people bothering you. You can't, like I said, you can't even go get groceries. Though. Well, I guess with the masks on, maybe people can ask. People don't recognize you as much. So, but I, if he does stay, I would love to see him win a cup. If anybody deserves it more than Pricer, I mean, that guy winning a cup in Montreal would be, I think that would bring tears to anybody's eyes. So, But we'll see what happens. It's kind of his choice, Montreal's choice. I don't really know.
Yeah, no, I agree with you, Prusty. And if he leaves town, these people that have been chirping him, they'll be wishing he was still there. I think Seattle will be a great fit for him. You talk about the Bell Center atmosphere, like everyone sacrificed through COVID, especially in Ontario where you are. But just talk about what these players have done playing in front of empty buildings all year round. Like, you remember going in the Bell Center, it was three quarters full for warm-up. Like, I couldn't imagine what these guys have sacrificed.
Yeah, I remember we'd do the white and red scrimmage games and people would be lined up at like 4 or 5 a.m. waiting because it was just free to come in to watch our before season scrimmage, like during training camp, and they'd sell out the Bell Center with free tickets. People were just waiting. So I know, you know what's hey, Uppy, you know what I remember when I tell people the most is when I got to Phoenix and coming out for the first game, for like, you know, just like after warmups and everything and coming out on the ice. And I'm like, yeah, you know, NHL game, new team. And then I look in the stands and there's like 1,000 people there. And I'm just, my feet went like this.
Yeah. There must've been a snowstorm. Everyone got caught in traffic.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So that was kind of a weird thing where I knew I liked to play in front of crowds, and totally. I love that adrenaline rush, and that gave me a lot of energy and shit and stuff like that. So, but I think everybody's on the same page playing in front of no fans. I mean, it'd definitely be weird, but everybody's doing it, I guess. And but I get that rush of the fans being there and, you know, knowing there's chicks in the stands watching you play and stuff, right, Uppy?
That's important. And also having a place to go after the game was also just as important.
Yeah, exactly.
You
know,
yeah,
without the mask, without, you know, the cameras following you.
Hey, just... that was another thing in New York. Torts made everybody put our phones. You'd have to get your phone and put it in a cell phone, in a case.
During the game?
When you walked in the room, as soon as you walked in the room at like 4:30 or 5,
my God.
I would have been fucked.
Because guys were making dinner plans. I think it was Aves. Aves obviously got caught. Was making dinner plans, and he was texting somebody that was with like one of the owners or something, one of the owners' wives or something. And Aves was texting where dinner was during the second intermission or something.
I'd make sure in case I did anything really fucking dumb or funny out on the ice that after the period, I'd be like sending messages around to people. Hey, did you see that fucking go? Like, if they fly over the boards there.
If they took Uppy's phone away from at 4:30, we had to get to the barn.
No one would have anything to do after the game.
I know. Uppy saved us a lot in Florida.
That's true.
Everyone would be like, where are we going now? I'm like, see, I told you. Let me hold my fucking damn phone.
I remember whenever we played in Florida, I was like, Uppy, what's going on for tomorrow night? Set me up.
Yeah, we had a couple good. When we got to Florida, I'm like, or when we got to Phoenix, I was like, I'm not living in this hotel, in that La Quinta whatever hotel. I'm like, I got to find a pad. So I go out, find a place. Nice little pad, hot tub, everything, eh, Prusty? And sure enough, like me, you, Dawsey, Wojtek wasn't on our team at that point. But anyway, we'd have a couple nights where we'd sneak down to Old Town. Like, our season was done, but we were actually playing good, you and me. We both got half decent deals leaving there, but it was like, you know, we're in Scottsdale, let's mix it. So a couple after parties, fake jams.
I remember after the season, we went and stayed at the W Hotel for a week. And I remember first walking into the W Hotel, like the first day, I'd never been there. And we walk up to the pool deck, and there's this pool party going on. And I remember thinking in my head, this is what heaven looks like. This is paradise.
Yeah.
Like, I was like, what? Like, you know, it's kind of my first year in the NHL. So I hadn't really seen anything like this. Women everywhere, and like it was like tens, and I was just like, Uppy, where are we? This stuff exists.
Like, we'd have old
you're like, what a league, eh, Prusty? What a league. Yeah.
And then we'd have Windbag there just telling us everything about everything that we needed to do. Hey, Winnie, shut up, man. We're gonna wear our nut huggers, we're gonna jump in here, all right? Then we're gonna go to Old Town and take these babes out. All right. All right, boys, we know how to do this. All right, Winnie, we got this. All right,
Winnie, just watch me. Watch how it's done, boys. Oh, you scared them away. Where'd they go?
Prusty, the NHL obviously just signed an awesome deal with ESPN and Turner Sports, and you've obviously been a pretty outspoken guy on social media. Do you think the NHL needs to loosen up their grip on these guys and give them kind of a little more freedom to express themselves and give the give these guys a chance to expand their brand?
Yeah, I think so for sure. I was even thinking the other day, it's funny whenever anything happens as a player and there's something that socially is you kind of have to go with guidelines. And I know whenever you do media at the beginning of the year or halfway through the year, the media says to the guys, this is what you're saying. And you don't say this and don't say, I'm like, so nobody has any voice really. Like that's why NHL interviews. And that's why even like analysts, it's all like pretty, you know, pretty boring because they have to say what they're told to say and they can't have their own opinion. Nobody can have their own opinion. That's why all NHL interviews are the exact same thing all the time because they're basically robots. The players are robots when it comes to media. And the media, I know that who did they sign there? Did they sign – or they signed like the color guys?
They signed Eddie Olchuk and TNT. Yeah.
Eddie Olchuk. Yeah, and who else?
Ferraro and Boucher just signed.
Oh, ESPN. Yeah, yeah. So, you know, those guys are, you know, Ferraro's pretty, he's pretty good. Like he can be controversial. He can say some stuff that's, you know, can spark some things too. But we'll see what happens. But I think just more TV cameras too, right? Like they got to think of another way of filming the game to make it better to watch on TV as well. So, but give the players a little more voice, let them say what they want and give their opinions and quit. That's the only sport that you can't really give your own opinion on anything.
Yeah. And Prusty, that's a great point about if they could find a better way to make the game look better on TV. Like I watch some of these games and I don't even know where the fucking puck is half the time. If they could really zone in and make it look better, that's going to help so much.
Well, how about this too? At training camp, we all do those stupid security meetings, right? Where they like scare the shit out of guys for getting girls pregnant, doing drugs, getting DUIs, do all this stuff. And then they also have the media one where they say, like you just said, Prusty, do this, do that, fucking whatever. Why don't they have like the creative fucking meeting where they have like a team of creative art guys come in and say, guys, this is a fucking fashion designer right here. Okay. You're going to go buy clothes over here. You're going to wear fucking nice clothes this year. You're going to learn how to talk to the media. You're going to learn how to use your social media to help us and to help your brand. Like that should be part of growing the game instead of like this, you know, fucking whatever. But did that come on?
Did that security meeting scare you up at all?
Not a chance. I would have my phone.
We had our earphones in for those security meetings.
I was going to say, they didn't take my phone away for those. I'd just be sitting working something for lunch or whatever for dinner then.
The only thing about that security meeting, Prusty, was I was like, what's that phone number? If I get in trouble, which guy do I got to call? That one there? Okay, I'll put that in my phone.
They handed out the security card with the NHL, your local guy. Guy, your team rep or whatever. I was like, oh, I'm gonna keep that one.
Yeah, I got to know him well every year wherever I was. I said, you need anything here, buddy, let me know just in case I gotta call you one of these times.
Still talk to all of them. Yeah.
Hey Prusty, obviously before this COVID nonsense and everything, but what is it about London, brother? Like Bowley, who we all love, and Drew Doughty, who's an unbelievable guy, Corey Perry. Like, what is it about going back there for you boys that makes it so much, like, Dewey was building a mansion in Hermosa Beach, and he's like, I'm going back to London. Like, what is it about London for you boys?
Yeah, I think it's just, I think we've created kind of a good group of friends. Everybody has, like, for Dewey, Doubts is from London, so I know all his family and friends are here. He's like me. All my family and friends are here, and my high school buddies, you know, my hockey buddies. For Bowley and... you know, Perry, they won a Memorial Cup here. So they made friends here too that are their best buddies now, right? And some family close by. And then the golf, like we golf everywhere. You know, we got a great golf course around here. So, and good training programs here. Like guys maybe, you know, meet their trainer when they're 18 and they stick with them. I know Doubts, I think, is still with the same trainer. I don't know. It's just London's a good city. It's a good city in the summer. I know when we played here, obviously Western University, lots of hot chicks for the guys.
That's what I was just going to ask you.
Some guys fall in love and stay here. You know, a lot of things happen, but London's a good city. It's not too big. It's not too small. You can do, you have your freedom. You can do what you want. Doubts can still go out here and Paris can still go out here. You're going to get bothered a little bit, but people aren't going to swarm you and be annoying really. So you can kind of be yourself. So it's a good city that way.
It was like Western University was like the ASU of Canada, right? Like it just seemed like every hot young chick that wanted to party and have a good time went to Western University, Prusty.
Yeah, it's definitely a good university that way. I think it's ranked number one in Canada for, I don't know who does these rankings, but they always say the hottest kids in Canada. But definitely when it's Frosh Week, you always see those creeps cruising around campus. You know, Uppy would be down there.
Uppy would 100% be down there.
If they open up those borders, I'm coming.
Prusty, what was the one bar I ripped up London one night with Paris? Jimmy Bob's or Jim Bob's?
Jim Bob's. Yeah.
I had a night there. That was a good time.
That was one of our. I remember one time it was Memorial Cup year, and we're all lined upside outside Jim Bob's, and it was the night before a game, and coach calls Paris, and he's like, "Everybody in for curfew?" And Paris is like, "Yeah, everybody's in," and we all know we're like, "Oh my god." Chocolate, the assistant coach is calling Paris and he's like, "Yeah, we're all in. Everybody's in bed." And he goes, "Yeah, that's funny because I'm looking at you motherfuckers in the lineup right now." But we were winning every game. Like, what was he going to do? He's just like, "You stupid fucks." He's like, "Just get home safe. Don't be too late. Don't do anything stupid." That was London there. So, I mean, it's a good hockey town too, right? So, and I think a lot of guys close with the Hunters too, and you know, still all the Bud Gardens there. There's a lot of things that bring guys back to London.
It's a great hockey city. And Josh Gratton, did you ever fight Gratz?
I did. I fought him in the minors. Yeah.
He's a
He's one of our good buddies here. So he's out coaching now, but. Yeah, he always comes back here. He loves London.
He's doing well now with Gratz too, but we're in junior. This is our third year, and we're coming back on the iron lung, and me and Gratz, we sneak some beers in, and we think we got him fooled or whatever, right? And we go to this like house party after we get back to K-Town. And we're like partying and dancing or whatever, and the one girl's like, "Hey, your assistant coach is at the door." We're like, "What?" We go to the door, and there's our assistant coach. He's like, "You fucking guys, get out, drag this out of the party." I was like, "If I'm the assistant coach, just give a shit next day. Don't show up to the fucking house and drag the boys out."
Yeah,
no wonder we're in last place. Fuck.
He just wanted to come check out all the young ones, bro.
Yeah,
he
did. I forget his name. What was his name? Yeah. Or something.
No wonder you're in last place right there.
Right? I'm like, come on. Have fun. Let the boys at least have fun.
Be like, "Hey, if you're in last place and you're losing, do what Torts does. Hey, boys, go out and do some drugs or something."
I text Torts today just saying we had you on, and I asked him what I said, "You going fishing, Torts?" He said, "Fucking rights, I am, Ope." So he's a big fisherman guy. So
yeah.
Prusty, you're the man. We appreciate it, buddy. Listen, let's get together whenever we fucking can. I should be home in August. If you're ever down here, let us know. We appreciate you're a warrior, and thanks for joining us.
Yeah, I'll hit you guys up for some golf when I'm down there. All right, boys?
All right, fella.
Sounds good, Prusty. Thanks, man.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Up dog, Scoopsy. Good life, baby. I got one on today. Little blue and black stripe, the pocket. I'll tell you what, I told you, Up, you could class this stuff up. You can wear this shirt to dinner, whatever you want. It's super comfortable. Goodlife is taking over my closet, bro. It's that and it's some Missin Curfew merch.
We both showed up today just looking fresh, looking soft, looking clean. I went with the green, the forest green with the baby red shorts. Yeah, those are nice. Jimmy, I know in Boston, cruising around, looking good, looking comfy is the way of the world over there. Give us what you got going, brother.
I actually just got a huge order of Goodlife coming in. And one of the things that I love is the joggers and the Luke Terry joggers. I'm going to need those boys when I'm down Cape Cod and that sunset is coming down because it gets a little chilly here still. It's still May. So the jogger is the play here right now.
For those of you that need a change of closet attire, now's the time. Don't look back. Get a new shirt. Get a new pair of shorts. Obes, I see you rocking the socks too. I mean, get a hat. Goodlife.com is where you need to be. Our curfew code is curfew20, baby, for 20% off. We recommend just looking fresh. Your girls will thank you. people will be jealous. They'll be wondering where you get it all. And the answer is goodlife.com, baby.
Updog, you make a great point. I was on their website the other day. They got some fresh new hats, flat style, flat brim style, which I love. Check them out. Wear them on the golf course. Wear them after you tee it up. If you don't have time for a rinse, I'm telling you, curfew 20, good life, baby. These guys knows what's up.
All right, crew, we got a DraftKings Top Titty Friday breakdown with our boy Jimmy Scoops Hayes from the East Coast here. Jimmy Scoops, break down last week's action. You're going to see that the old Updog here laid an egg. Not perfect.
Updog, I was going through it because I was seeing myself almost at the top of the list there with the 16th place finish. That's my highest finish yet. So, you know, I might be able to get myself one of these DraftKings World Championships here soon. But with you with the no lineup,
bud, up, baby.
What type of penalty are we going to have to give you? We might have to start a Missin Curfew fine fun here, bud.
That's exactly it. I pretty much PDA'd. I was making out at the bar, and I forgot to put in my thing.
I reserved it.
Fuck, I reserved it, and then lo and behold, you know, I wasn't making out in the bar. But a PDA public display of affection is worth $500 on the road in the NHL. But I was golfing Riviera with a couple of my buddies, sickest club in LA, and I reserved it in the morning. I got up there, started having a couple transfusions, and next thing you know, I'm sitting there at 4:03 with my, you know.
I was trying to figure out what we're going to give the Updog. I was thinking about giving you the old 2 minutes for a delay of game, not putting the lineup in time, or doing the old 2 minutes for submitting the wrong lineup. Have you ever been in one of those scenarios where the coach, like I was in a team in Wilkes-Barre, and we got a power play right off the hop because the team submitted the wrong lineup. Have you ever been associated with that?
Yeah. It's either the guy has to pull himself out of the lineup because the coach fucked up. It's usually when the coach is hungover too.
Oh, yeah.
And it starts sometimes after the anthem, like the ref will come over and be like, hey, you got to pull Hayes off the lineup here. He shouldn't be out there to start this game anyway, but let alone you didn't put him on the game sheet. You know, I think that's just an old whoopsie doozy.
Yeah. Well, I mean, Obes had a pretty decent showing, but Obes just needs to do some, checking the stat sheet before, because he had Nathan MacKinnon, and Nathan MacKinnon didn't play in the game. So that's a big donut for the O'Brien. But let's give a quick shout out here to our boy B. Dennehy, 88. He ended up winning the top titty this week with 165.1 points. And I mean, this guy's lineup was fucking. He had his top lineup players were Connor Garland, the kid out of Arizona. He had a goal and two assists.
What a goal he had.
Yeah. Oh, how about that goal? That goal
backhand fucking flipski over the stick, coming down like he was running out of real estate. Came in little flipski over, just tucker in the back of the net. That's not a bad snipe.
No, that was a big time goal. But the performer of the week that he had, and I know you and Owens would love this, was the veteran Joe Pavelski. He had two goals, four shots on net, two assists, and one block shot. And block shots in the top titty are worth points. So he had 37.3 points. And I just love seeing veterans light up the stat sheet up.
Yeah, absolutely. Pav's a good man, although he's going to have those irons and those drivers out here this week, because Dallas is done. But Pav proved that he's still a veteran guy that can contribute and produce, and he ain't going anywhere, folks. He's going to be in this league for another couple of years. He's playing well and obviously lighting up the fantasy charts.
And of course, this week was my first chance to get the Philadelphia Flyers involved in the Top Titty League for them playing on Friday. And of course, I rode my boy, my brother, Kevin Hayes, and he delivered with 16 fantasy points. He had five shots on goal, one assist, and he had a block shot, which was kind of nuts. I don't see him blocking many shots. But one guy that both me and Denny had in common was Cale Makar. And this guy, if he's available on Friday night, Top Titty, you have to take him. This guy fucks every week. I've been riding him almost every time that I had a chance to take him. He had 28 points for me, and he was a huge reason why I actually got myself in the top 16.
Yeah, I'm a Cale Makar fan through and through. Guy moves fucking like butter out there, and I'm excited to watch him in a playoff run. I think it's going to be something special watching those that Western Division really battle it out here.
Yeah, Uppy, and I like to, when I'm doing my lineups here, I like to look both at the veterans and some of the young guys that you can get at the low cost and the high value. And one guy was the young kid, Wade Allison. He had 22 fantasy points, and he only cost you $2,500. So when you're being a GM building these lineups, you need to be able to find those young guys. And what do you think about last week with the playoff spots already clinched? Do you think guys check out? Is that the time to take young guys?
That's a great point. I mean, it's a time where the real GMs give these kids a chance, right? It's like, you know, guys have their opportunity. A GM sits out his three best players. One guy's got a broken fingernail, so he's done. You know, goalies get a new chance, so maybe you find out who's playing in net. You take a young goalie. But you're right. All these kids get their opportunity to showcase for next year, showcase for, you know, who's going to have to come back and sweat it out at a summer camp. You know what those are all about. I used to hate those. But yeah, you're right. I think a smart fantasy sports GM down the stretch, Jimmy, here in DraftKings, really knows, like, all right, what kid's going to get this opportunity? What GM's going to let these kids roll? Are they going to play power play? Are they going to be guys, you know, getting out on the 5-on-3? You know, we're really starting to see some of the top names stay at the top of that top titty league week after week. So, you know they're digging. They're finding something that we don't know.
Yeah, and I think, like, guys, like you do, like, when you're playing, you play for the whole year. These points are valuable for you. You know, score a goal here, get an assist. You add that point total. That's big for contract reasons. So guys that are having contracts coming up, you think these veterans are going to continue to play. And then moving on to this week, Uppy, we only got one game on the slate. And I think having that one game is going to be a true one-on-one. See who can get the best roster out there to take down the top titty this week. And this week's game is Toronto versus Winnipeg Jets. And a guy that I'm going to ride this week is Morrissey from Winnipeg Jets. And the reason is he's a big-name guy, and he has 0 points in his last four games. So these are the guys that I don't think they can stay off the stat sheet for that many games in a row.
Hazy, I think this is a prime example of trying to dig, maybe get a little inside info, reach out to the guys you know, and see who's not playing. See which young kids are going to get a chance in this lineup to think about it. It's a Friday night game. These guys are going to play, you know, I would say the Jets and Edmonton, and we'll start to kind of see the schedule come out here right away. They're going to play here in a couple days. They're top guys. I mean, yes, is Matthews going to play 23, 24 minutes? Probably not. Marner, probably the same thing. And then you look across, like Kyle Connor, Scheifele, that, you know, they're big buck guys, but this might be a chance to build your lineup around a lot of younger guys, you know, fill up the lineup with those $3,000-$4,000 guys, and just see where it can take you. Maybe you sneak up from behind and get a title before the playoff starts.
Yeah, 100%. That's where I'm going to have to put my GM thinking cap on. So this week, Friday night, top titty, one game. Let's see what you got. You got to be a big time GM this week to be able to come out on top here. And we thank all the people that are participating in our top titty each week. It means a lot to us. And it's a lot of fun looking at these standings and seeing some names up there. And I love seeing my name ahead of you and Obes. So for me to get some wins, I think that's three in a row for me. So Broadway's starting to figure out this DraftKings. But the one thing I want to talk about with you right now is gambling. And DraftKings got the sportsbook app, and they're going to allow us to start boosting some odds here. And you know me with the Parlay Cafe, I love putting these guys into these player prop bets and having teams win. And this week we're going to feature that Boston-Washington playoff game. And I'm riding Taylor Hall, Brad Marchand, to record a point, and the Bruins to win. And DraftKings is going to be happy to boost those odds for our listeners.
Jimmy, you just hit it right on the nose. This is right up your alley. And we are here at Missin Curfew excited to bring our fans, our listeners, the Jimmy Scoops Cafe Parlay or Parlay Cafe. Every fucking week we're hitting our fans with some picks, some odds boosts. DraftKings, great meeting with their team yesterday. Really excited about creating some excitement around some odds boosts and getting some money into our fans' pockets. If our fans are happy, we're happy. Scoopsy, you're doing a hell of a job digging and creating some great bets for the boys. And we all look forward to this playoff run. Look forward to this weekend's action. Saturday night, big match.
It's a huge match. And you know what? There's nothing better leaving the weekend when you go out with the fellas. You might run up a nice bar tab. having that Saturday night money right back in your pocket. It's like you basically went out for free, up dog.
You're damn right, Scoopsy. Well, we will tune in and we will see the odds boost. Tune in to DraftKings.com, Jimmy Hayes, and we will provide some fans some great opportunities to win some cash on the DraftKings Sportsbook. And fucking A, here we go.
Here we go.
Up dog, thanks to Prusty. Great guy, good pull. You can tell he goes on Twitter. He tells his, you know, how he feels. He doesn't care about what people say back to him. And a guy that was undersized his whole career and would chuck him with anybody.
Super well respected by teammates, by other players, by coaches, like referees. The guy never backed down from a fucking fight or a battle. And he could put the puck in the net. He was just a well-rounded player that was, you know, in junior, probably wasn't touted to ever play in the NHL. I loved my tenure with him. I had him in Phoenix, a couple hot tub parties with a couple of smoke shows, and we were living life, baby, back then. And then
that's NHL.
That is fucking NHL hockey.
That is NHL. So
shout out to Prusty for coming on. And then Jimmy Scoops Hayes coming at us with some fucking fantasy picks
top
for the
titty.
Top titty, baby.
Did you get in the Parlay Cafe, or we will get in the Parlay Cafe with them eventually?
We are Parlay Cafe. This weekend's a big weekend, so we want everyone to tune in. We're going to have some live boosts for our boosts for our DraftKings Sportsbook. So all of you out there that can throw some cash down on some bets, Jimmy Scoops Hayes will be throwing these live. And we thank Jimmy for breaking that down for us.
He picked a two-teamer last night. He picked the Caps, and he picked the Winnipeg Jets, who I wanted to get in. But they fucking started. They started early.
How you guys won that Caps game is fucked too. By the way,
Boston had nobody playing. I actually did my homework for once. They rested everyone. Yeah. Marchand, Bergeron, Pasternak, and I still almost lost the fucking bet. So there,
Raffle threw it in the top shelf from the fucking corner.
With 1.8.
Yeah, that was it.
I was having a skinny marg at Big Canyon with Doherty and Brian Gale, and I had the game on, and 1.8 seconds. That never happens. So
that's great.
To Scoopsy, Parlay Cafe, top titty. Fuck, it's the time of year to just get the bets going. And for playoff hockey, I'm fired up, Ups.
Awesome.
Missin Curfew. Just to know we're safe, I am.